Good morning and thank you. It is my pleasure to welcome everyone to our 6th annual Community Day. This day is all about you, our community, the day we all come together to share what we have been doing with the HPCC Systems platform across industry, academia, and in our own business. So I'd also like to welcome our live stream audience tuning in from all around the globe. Please engage with us by sharing your comments and feedback across social media using hashtag HPCC Summit. And for our attendees in the room with us, please refer to your mobile app to keep up with the agenda and other happenings throughout the day. Trust me, it will be action-packed. So before we get started, I want to give a huge thank you to our sponsors this year. We have Dell Technologies, our platinum sponsor. They provided a dinner last night that was very tasty for those who attended. And today, they are also providing the little power stations at the tables to make sure our devices stay fully charged, which is important. So thank you, Dell Technologies. Okay. I think they're there. There's Joe. I see him. Okay. And a big thanks to Infosys, our gold sponsor, who is covering our coffee breaks today to keep ourselves fully charged, which is also equally important. And to our bronze sponsors, Datum Software and K-Force, thank you for your continued support and the awesome little swag in the bags that we got. Okay, so the format for today. We have a fantastic speaker lineup in both our general and breakout sessions. And something new that we introduced this year, which you got a taste of last night, is our interactive expo. So this is your chance to engage with our subject matter experts, check out some really cool demos and exhibits, and yes, as you may have seen, the robots are back and better than ever. So let's get started. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm really excited to have our keynote speaker kick things off, someone we're all familiar with who needs no introduction, but he's so worthy of one. He has been the face, voice, and our most strongest advocate in our open source community. Please help me welcome Vice President of Technology, RELX Distinguished Technologist, Head of HPCC Systems, and most importantly today, my co-MC, Dr. Flavio Villanustre.
Hello, everyone. And you saw, for a change, we have now a different MC, and we co-MC a little bit of the entire sessions today. But for this particular session, I will do the keynote piece. I will cover some things that some of you might remember, and then some things that you might or might not know coming down the road, and even on the floor outside of the demo. How many of you have been to the demo floor yesterday, last night? Quite a few of you. Well, for those that haven't, if you are just here this morning, please go do go to the demos. There is plenty of material there, and some of the things that I will present now will be there as well for you to play with and see how they work. Anyway, so I ask you to walk with me down the memory lane because this particular community day is special. It's not your traditional community day. These things can only happen once every 20 years. So let's get going. The past 20 years, trying to put something that moves slowly, you see a moon phase complication there that typically takes 27 days to rotate. It's not slow enough to show 20 years, but at least it's slower than a normal clock. So how many of you have owned one of these? Can you raise your hands? Oh, wow. So this is 2001. For those that didn't own one of these and don't even know what it is, it was a music player. But it was a music player that you needed to connect to your computer to load music on. There wasn't iTunes or anything like that. So that sounds so retro, so boring, right? We don't even remember this. This was less than 20 years ago. How about this? How many of you use one of these? Do you know what it is? No, it's not a toaster. This was the first smartphone from a company that is not a fashion clothes designer. It was a phone company, a Canadian company that nowadays is a little bit on the bad side. But this initiated a revolution. Same as the iPod that you saw before, even though the company might or might not be successful today, What they started then is now every one of our smartphones. How about this company? A little company that built a little portal. Did you even see this portal when it was like that? Did anyone see this? No, of course. Yeah, someone saw. Yeah, maybe one person or two. So again, something that now we give standard. We just don't question if Facebook will exist tomorrow or exists there, even though less than how many years? 15 years ago, it was just a little project out there, a book for students in Harvard. How about this? Who would think that writing 140 characters would make any sense? And look at Twitter today. This is Jack Dorsey. This is the founder of Twitter, setting up his first tweet account in 2006. Interestingly enough, a few years later, Twitter is, again, another one of the well-established social media systems, and we can't get away without it. By the way, don't forget to tweet about this event. You know the hashtag. Those that are in the live audience, remember, Twitter will have a hopefully a good feed going on there as well. Now, how about this device? I didn't want to bring up the real first tablet, which was the tablet PC. How many of you remember tablet PCs? Dell folks, you probably remember them, right? Back in the day. Well, those was a failed attempt at a tablet back in the early 2000s. But then this company came up, the same one that came up with the iPod, came up with this idea. And now this idea pretty much revolutionized the way we do day-to-day computing. We use our phones, we use our tablets, and this is now very well established as a technology that we wouldn't perhaps be able to live without today. So you can see how over the last 20 years there has been a significant increase in innovation across technology. The companies have come up with ideas that now seem to be fairly established, but they were just ideas back then. Of course, I didn't include any of the ideas that failed and didn't go anywhere, but these are the successful ideas that eventually ended up being here today, maybe by the same companies, maybe by other companies, but all of these are still relevant and will be relevant for the time to come. Now, for the next image, I want to go back, now truly 20 years, 1999, September 1999. I don't want to, you to think that there is any romantic connotation to the title. You'll see what I mean when I show it. But this is the time when HPCC was originally thought about. This is when the idea got crystallized. Those two people who seem to be drinking from the fountain of youth because they look exactly like that. So if you don't know those two people, who are Richard and Gavin, wherever they are. You can look for them in the room because they look exactly like that. I don't know what they do to keep 20 years behind and still be as young as then. But these are the few people that were involved in that first Clarion 1999 conference where there were the first discussions around the very first component of what became then the HPCC. Of course, HPCC hasn't been the same HPCC along 20 years. We have evolved so much. We have added so many capabilities, new features. We have grown scalability. We have done a lot of innovation around capabilities on user interaction and in data integration and on and on. I just can't cover all of them. But I can tell you that we were the first in many, many things, many innovations that came up in the industry and now are taken as something that has been established as a way to do things. It came up in HPCC a long time ago. Let me tell you this history of firsts. So 1999, those people were thinking about HPCC. They came up with a design. They were just there on the boat. They floated the first ideas about it. There you go, to make a good allusion there, pun intended. And then in 2001, we had the first component of HPCC. How many of you know Holly? Not that many nowadays. Holly has been deprecated a long time ago, even though some customers continue to use it for several years after deprecation. and as far as maybe last year or 2 years ago. But Holi was the very first in-memory distributed database in the world. Nobody thought about using an in-memory database in a distributed system to do their accelerate their queries. Now they don't need indices. They can just query the data. Browse memory, which was quite fast. Small memory. Back in the day, we are talking about computers that would have 1 gigabyte of memory. If you were lucky, you could have a little bit more of that. But that was a quite interesting idea, and that worked very well. Now, very close to that, the first inception of the ECL language came up. And ECL as a language, you can still think that it's quite interesting today, a data flow language. Data flow languages back in the day were a little bit on the downside. People were writing the imperative language wave, so everyone wanted to do imperative and procedural languages. However, a few years later, around 2005 or 2006, when processors couldn't continue to scale using Moore's law to grow scalability by just accelerating the clock, and they started using multi-core systems and hyper-threading and all that, those imperative languages were very hard to program in multi-processor environments. And data flow languages and functional languages came up as an important new concept, new old concept, as we had it before. So ECL, yes, truly was the first data flow language. Nowadays, of course, you find TensorFlow, which is another data flow language for data analysis for machine learning. But ECL was the first for a long time. The first distributed data integration system, THOR. Once we had Holi, and I don't want to give away a lot of things that Richard will cover and others will cover, Richard Chapman, who is around, in his talks. But once we had Holi, we needed to have a system to create data. And now we built THOR, 2001. This is the first distributed data integration system out there. I haven't heard of any back then. In 2002, we need now a good, fast query system, and the idea of RELX came up, and we have RELX. Yeah, surely we deprecated Holi nowadays because it makes little sense. We have everything else covered already by RELX, but every one of the other systems are still out there, active, and continue to grow and evolve. Now, in comparison, to see how first this first was, look at when, this is not, even though I put the elephant there, this is not the time when Hadoop came to inception. Hadoop didn't come to inception until 2005. But the very first paper on MapReduce as a method of doing distributed data processing by these two Google researchers came up in OSDI in December 2004. We are talking about 5 years after HPCC was designed. That's quite good. They say good first, right? And I can't say that Google was a copycat, and it wasn't. It was based on a different principle, but still, they were a follower back then. So this is good about history, and now I'll take you, I pulled you out from the memory lane, and we will go to what we have today and what we are building. And as this is part of some, I won't cover the entire roadmap. There is no way I can cover that here in this keynote, but I can tell you a few things about new innovation in a number of areas that might be quite useful to many of you. So, almost everyone here, I assume, will agree. Do you agree that this is pretty much where a data lake requires, right? And some of these items, I bolded them just because I thought they were quite important and areas that we need to cover. And you'll see how this plays in the rest of the presentation, in the rest of the keynote. But essentially, all of these things are givens when you are trying to build a data lake. If you are missing some of these components, it will end up being either very expensive, it will end, or very complicated to implement, or you won't be able to track data properly, or you might not be able to scale up to the performance that you need, and on and on. So all of these things are really, I say, in 2019, are pretty essential if you are trying to build a data lake. Now, we believe that we can build this on HPCC. And we have many of these components already, and we are adding those that we didn't have as well defined or developed to give the users an out-of-the-box solution where they can build their data lake without adding anything else. Just throw HPCC, for God's sake, throw open source HPCC, and you have a complete, fully featured data lake to be used for any application. And many of our open source community users know this and use it day to day for many, even mission critical applications. Now, one of the lines in the previous slide was about speed of ingestion. And that is key when it comes to IoT, Internet of Things. You have nowadays, we are moving more and more towards this inundation of sensors all over the world, from your Fitbits to your connected cars, to your sensors, thermostats in your home, to remote tracking devices through cameras, through other things. All of these sensors create a significant amount of data. Data that needs to be ingested and processed and linked and alerted upon, and dashboards need to be created. And all of this can be handled with HPCC. Of course, there is one more component that I didn't depict here because it's not HPC-centric, which is the edge compute, please. Many times, you cannot just transport all the data. There is just no enough speed, even though 5G is out there as the biggest thing out under the sun. But if you take out edge computing, which might not be a good fit for HPCC, because it's just purely stream processing, you can do everything else for this in HPCC, and I'll show you how you can do it. Of course, this wouldn't be a useful talk unless we had actual things to show, actual things that work. And the things that I will mention and we'll cover later on are all on the floor. So not when I finish the talk, because we will have another talk better than this one, but when we have a break, go to the floor, take a look at the demos, and look at these components. We will cover some of these. You can see how we continue to use the same approach that we had throughout these last 20 years by building additional layers of abstraction, one over the other, reusing components, and bringing the hardware and the data closer and closer to the user, right? The hardware at the bottom, the user at the top, and the closer you get to the user, the closer you get to something that is extremely expressive, easy to use, easy to interact with, and it provides the information that the user needs at the time they need it. And, of course, 2019, machine learning wouldn't be missing there. This was one of the areas that I mentioned before. There is a significant amount of work done by a number of people in this room in machine learning, and people outside of the room too, those in the live stream as well. The community has really picked up the steam on machine learning and is driving a number of capabilities that we could only dream of a few years ago. Plenty of this doesn't intend to be a comprehensive summary of what we are doing. This is just some key topics that I thought I would just highlight today. But there are plenty of other areas of research and development. And again, many people in this room and in the live stream and others that are not even there are working actively on this. And some of the posters, by the way, how many of you saw the posters that we had outside? Some of you did, some of you didn't. So please, if you have a minute in the breaks, go take a look at the posters. We have very good posters. We had a poster competition with 13 posters this year, and we have 3 winners. I don't know who they are yet, but hopefully we will know in a couple hours. Stay tuned. So now, let's go to the meat of these new capabilities. What if? What if you could write your ECL code directly on the cloud? All you needed was a web browser. Sounds good. Sounds like an ECL playground. How many of you play with ECL Playground? Several of you. Well, if you haven't and you'd like to try quick things in HPCC, ECL Playground is a nice place to start. But it has limitations. You may not be able to import a module. You might not be able to access data in certain ways. It's hard to upload data to. But what if you didn't have any of these limitations? What if you could just have an interface where you can just code your ECL code and it will run in the cloud and you don't need to bother about anything else, You can upload your data from there, you can work with it, and you can create charts. You can use the entire visualization engine of HPCC directly on your browser. You can build dashboards interactively and just with a web browser. This is the new ECL Cloud ID. If you haven't seen it, again, demo floor, go take a look. This gives you capabilities that are close to what you get with a normal ECL ID or your normal IDs, but just browser-based. Highly interactive, allows you to do things like this. You can see how you can build visualization, dashboards. You can get access to your, we call it scripts there. They are, of course, work units and queries, but they are not meant to be extensive, right? At least not yet. We have some limitations that we have artificially created there. For example, the amount of data that you can upload. We are intending to use this as a way to take our ECL playground to the next level. Eventually, this limitation might disappear, and we might make it fully functional. But there is a road there. For now, there is plenty to use, plenty to enjoy, and to leverage from that ECL Cloud ID. Again, take a look in the demo floor. Another area that we believe that has a... Oh, there you go. Another area that we believe that has a significant... some opportunities to improve on and add to. And that is the area of data provenance. So in many cases, and this is not just a LexisNexis specific need, yeah, surely we have this need, but many people in this room, in other companies and organizations have the same need. You ingest data into an HPCC environment, and you need to know which fields in those data sets are transported all the way to the end results. You need to know how these fields are transformed across. If you have a project, what does a transform do? You need to be able to label this data based on not just the types of the fields, because, yeah, surely, the types of the fields, ECL is a strongly typed language, so you know it from ECL if you're with ECL. But the problem is the content of the fields. It's not the type just. It might be that you want to know if there is SPII in that field, or PII. But for those that don't get the acronym, private information or private identifiable information or person identifiable information. So if you want to do that, it can be a little bit difficult at this point. It might take a little bit of work, and it would require quite a bit of extra work to build it in some way in your ECL code or use another tool outside of ECL and HPCC to extract this. And of course, understanding how this data flows, as I mentioned before, being able to understand how a particular field impacts the outcome of a computation. You have these data sets coming in, this output coming out, which parts of this data set are representing the output, and how they are. Is it anonymized? Is it not anonymized? Which one of these fields go in? So in order to tackle this particular problem, we built a tool called Tombolo. Tombolo can read directly from HPCC the data sets. You can label what they have. You can label their the fields that are involved there. So now you can have full metadata provenance in your and provenance tracking in your data lake. Now you can do things like this. You can see the fields. You can know what they have, data type, not just the type of the field, strings, all of them strings in that case, but also the metadata type for the data type. This is healthcare information, protected healthcare information. And you could have SPII, you could have other types of data. And you can create reports telling you how much of that is available there and how those dependencies operate. This tool at this point is still in high development. All of this is available. Nothing that I'm saying is not available today. There are additional things that we want to build around automation that will be future development, including the ability to read this directly from the work units, so there is less and less work needed by the user when they try to do this type of things. Again, all of this coming out, all of this highly needed if you are trying to build a fully functional data lake. Now, how many of you use ECL Watch? Can you raise your hands? Oh, all of you do. Okay, good. That's good. You should. Well, if you use ECL Watch, how many functions does ECL Watch have today? 10? More, right? 20? 30? 100? Well, so since we believe that ECL Watch didn't have enough capabilities, let's add one more. What if we really wanted to do automated data discovery? Exploratory data analysis. What if we wanted to profile the data that is coming in automatically? So I throw a data set, a new data set that I load, and I want the computer to tell me, what is in the data set? Not just the type of the field, this is just strings, but also, tell me more about this. These are the strings that are most likely names of people, and they are distributed with this particular distribution. They are, well, I'm not gonna tell you more things, I'll just show you. You can get this automatically. This is using the data. How many of you use the data patterns bundle? Data patterns bundle. Some of you did. Well, if you haven't used it, it can give you this. But now it can give you this integrated in ECL watch. So you open your ECL watch in the latest version of HPC, of course. How many of you are on the 7 version of HPC? 7.2, 7.4, 7.4? How many on 7.4? Okay, a few are, very good. So if you are on 7.4, you will start getting these things, these capabilities. Please, if you haven't upgraded, this is more than an incentive to upgrade. Upgrade, move forward. Not for your production environment initially, of course, move to a development environment, test it. But these things are truly new disruptive capabilities. They can give you a lot of lift for what you do. You don't need to spend more time trying to go through the data and understand the data yourself, or run external profiling tools, data profiling tools, and then getting that data, that metadata, imported back into your ECL program. This gives you the information and builds your field description, your record layouts automatically, if you use it, of course. And I mentioned the names. So this continues to move. This is a moving target. Unfortunately, I wrote this presentation last week. And by Thursday, Dan Camper contacted me because he was building a new way to do also fuzzy matching that was far more performing than what we had before. This is Levenstein distance, but in a way that you get a big performance lift, particularly if you have a huge dictionary of words, 8 million of them on one side, and you want, let's say you have a dictionary of all names possible in English, 8 million of them on one side, you want to match any string that comes in to any name to know if it's one of those names, or if it's close enough to one of those names. And that Levenstein distance, if you are a, how many of you have ever programmed Levenstein distance using dynamic programming by hand? C, Python, Java, whatever. So you, some of you have, you know, that is quite resource intensive, right? It takes time to do it across two words. Now, if you have 8 million words and you have 10,000 words on the other side that you want to match with any one of those 1 million words, this is a combinatorial scale problem. Well, he managed to do it. That might be another enhancement that will go with the name, the discovery of fields. So now we can discover those fields based on dictionaries, and we can even do that if the components in those fields are close, but not exactly the same. And you can define how close they need to be. Anyway, just closing, and I have only a few seconds. HPC of things, I thought it was a clever acronym, HOT, HPC of things, but it's a bad joke, yes, I know. It's a corny joke, forget about it. So this is what I said before, but the interesting thing is that we just built something that is called IoT Hub. Now, ingesting data from certain sensors, and we have right now connected cars, with GM cards, we're using a GM simulator and of course, cards, Ecobee devices, and Fitbit devices, is now as simple as just going to that portal and entering the information, and it will automatically get the approvals to be able to access the information and create dashboards like this. And even display that back into the connected car trip score on the cars, on the car console. All of this, again, highly usable, out of the box able, and with the possibility of extending it to any type of device, really. This just needs more connectors, and as we continue to move, we will continue to add connectors, and others in the community will as well. And of course, capabilities. We have more still down the road in the pipeline for this one, but this is quite exciting. We've been using it for a number of tests, and it just works very nicely. Later today, almost close to the end of the day, you will see the new streamlined website. I won't give out any of this. Jessica has a great session on that. And just to close it, these are the things that we really believe on and we are doing right now, as you saw. We want out-of-the-box capabilities. We want to ensure that you can use things as they come out without needing to do a lot of work to do it. We want less coding and more using. You should be able to use most of the things out of the box without needing to go through a lengthy session of coding, even though we do love to code. But this is good for users. At least it gets new users and users that are not coders closer to the platform and able to use the platform, even though they don't have that particular skill. And as usual, for the last 20 years, we continue to aim at being your one-stop shop for all of your data integration, querying, and analytical needs. And I think I covered quite a bit that we have today, and there is always more to come. And HP Systems, I thought this slogan would be very appropriate. We code, so you don't need to. So, by the way, don't take that literally, and please code and send contributions back. So, thank you very much. Now, before I leave the floor, I need to invite three colleagues of mine. These three people are quite close to me. They've been with the company for a very long time. One of them is soon to retire, unfortunately, after decades with the company, which is good. But they have a good story around using HPCC for security, privacy, and compliance. They are going to be telling you how they use HPCC to do fraud detection, to do threat analysis, and to do quite important capabilities that we need across the business to identify fraudsters, identify bad actors, and quickly address those. So without much more preamble, and I wouldn't be able to do honor to their resumes and their skills and talent, I want to invite here Andy Baer, Marcus Mullins, and Naweed Mohammed. They are going to be presenting this next talk here. Thank you. Please give them a hand.
Good. Want to go off?
You guys going to stay down there?
Yeah.
Thank you, Flavio. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Andy Baer. I'll start off our talk on, as Flavio said, we're leveraging the HPC systems as part of our information security, privacy, and compliance framework. I'm going to go over a little bit about the IADP, Information Assurance and Data Protection Group. Marcus will talk about some operational considerations, and then Naweed will come in and talk really about the project, how we're using HPC systems to meet the needs. So I'm going to really talk more about what the IADP does, and hopefully it'll highlight why we need to use the HPC systems. So as Flavio said, the IADP, Information Assurance and Data Protection Group, is really an oversight organization for the RELX Group in the areas of security, client practices, and we work mostly with the risk solutions and legal and professional business, and we focus really on protecting PII, the personally identifiable and SPII data that's made available through our online products. We've been doing that for several years. And as Flavio said, one of the key functions that we perform is fraud detection for the business. You know, mitigate risk by detecting anomalous activity that may be an indication of fraud. Investigations and incident response, which follows after there's been some potential incident. So we have an investigations team that conducts security investigations and responds using various tools and processes that are in place, and I'll go into some of those later. And then there's the ongoing compliance that we do, and there's a lot of different areas that we focus on around compliance. I'm going to talk about how we use some of the data to do that in some customer audits, but it's really to meet the requirements of regulatory laws, data provider restrictions, internal policies. So we have organization within the IADP that does that. But before I get into those in more detail, I want to talk about one of the key factors to make all of those work, which is the data. In order for the IADP to perform these functions, we collect and retain data from numerous online product repositories across the business, things like Accurant, LexisAdvance, Credit Portal, whatever. And the four types of data that we really focus on are our customer account metadata, the account name, customer name, the account, the number, their address, the list of users within the account. We collect that for all of the products that we monitor. We also look at administrative activity logs. When there's a new IP address added to an account, for example, or a new ID is created, passwords are reset, we collect all of that information on an ongoing basis. We have the product authentication logs. When someone logs in to the front end of the product, we track successful logins, whether they've satisfied their multi-factor authentication as they're logging in. We have things like failed login attempts. All of that is collected and used for these processes. And then the last and probably the most important is the transaction logs, the searches that were run by the user on the products, including the search terms, the timestamp that it was done, the session information. All of that is collected. And not just for one product. We're talking, you know, all of our online products that serve up public records. I won't go into the volume. I think Naweed and Marcus will have some numbers around that. But I just wanted to touch on that, you know, the key for doing those three main functions is the data. Without the data, we couldn't do those. So let me talk a little bit about fraud detection. And really, our fraud detection is a system that processes the activity through a set of rules that then identify potentially suspicious behavior. Not necessarily saying it is fraud, but it's an indication that something popped up against one of our rules. And we use things like the geolocation, IP addresses, timestamp, industries, the way the user authenticated. Did they come in through normal authentication? Was it through federated access, and then we look at the search type. What search did they run? What was the velocity of the searches? Volume, how many searches were run? And then we also look at previous behavior by that user over time. So there's a lot that goes in here, but essentially it's, you know, we take the data, we run it through a set of rules, and then there's an indication that it may be suspicious activity. Then that goes to our investigations team. That indication of potential fraud or suspicious activity goes into a workflow tool that our investigators use. From there, they run searches, queries against the data that we're housing in our system to get additional, perhaps, searches done by that user over time. They may look at some of the administrative logs around that same time, and so on. And then from there, they do their analysis to determine if it was, in fact, fraud, and then take action. I won't really talk about that, because really, once they've gotten their reports, that's the use of the data. After that, they do their work to analyze it, review it, and make decisions on what action to take if there was, in fact, fraud. And then finally, we have our ongoing compliance, and the piece I'll talk about there is our customer audits. So we have an organization that works with our customers and sends them searches that they've done to determine if they were authorized in accordance with legal and regulatory and even our own policies. And there's three types of audits that are done. There's random audits where we select randomly select accounts and pull a random number of searches that get sent to the customer. There's ones that are called event-driven where it may be something that came from our investigations team. It wasn't necessarily fraud, but it was an indication that there may be something suspicious there, so let's perform an audit. And then there's audits that are done when searches are done on high-profile individuals. So again, we from the data that we've collected, it goes through a workflow tool, sends a set of transactions off to the customer. The customer then responds back saying yes or no, it was done properly. I won't go into a lot of that, but really it was the focus on the data. And then the last thing I want to talk about briefly is, you know, how are we looking to continuously improve? For our organization to respond more appropriately now and in the future, we have to capitalize on data and analysis that's available using some new technologies. And there's two areas that we that we think about when we look at our improvement is effectiveness. Are we monitoring, alerting, and auditing on the right things? And I won't go into a lot of that, but going forward, we wanna really emphasize behavioral versus location and time-based analytics. So that's where you may think of machine learning down the road or things like that. Shift to maybe data modeling instead of reactive responses. So how can we get there? And some of the things Flavio mentioned earlier may be available to us. And then last is efficiency. Do we identify suspicious activity and respond to them quickly and accurately? And how do we do that? So we want to have increased use of visualization and analytic tools. When we talk about our investigators having to review transactions, that could be hundreds or thousands of lines of transactions. So how can we make that easier for them? And then we also want to look at how we can improve the workflow integration and pull some of the data that's being used into the tools that they use to do their analysis. So that's kind of an overview of our organization. And I'm going to turn it over to Marcus, who will talk about some operational considerations.
Thank you, Andy. Good morning. Let me get this. Today I'm going to discuss a few of the operational aspects that we had to consider when we were integrating HPCC into our existing infrastructure, starting with workflow integration. As you can see from this high-level diagram, starting from the left, it all starts with a customer logs into a product. They perform various transactions. All of that activity is logged, and then we collect that activity, those logs, into our landing zone for our cluster. We then ingest the data from the landing zone into our cluster. So that's the data ingestion portion of our process. We then have, on the other side of the equation, all of the output from that data. We have various reporting tools. We are implementing fraud detection analytics. And via those reporting tools, an IADP staff member can then access the data in various ways. We also need to implement a type of process state tracking. We need to be able to coordinate between our tools, such as the reporting tools, processes running on the landing zone. And so we use MySQL to basically coordinate the state between the processes. We also use that data in MySQL to be able to present alerts, present data on a dashboard, various other mechanisms so that IADP operations staff can monitor the data ingestion as well as the flow of report queries, et cetera, to make sure everything's healthy. We also have to consider data management. We're pulling all of this data, actually over 30 gigabytes a day, into the landing zone to process. And so we have to implement some kind of automated truncation process to roll older age data off of the landing zone so we don't fill it up. We also have to worry about data normalization. Since we're pulling this data in from over 60 different sources coming from various products, we have to be able to normalize that data that's formatted in different ways, it's organized and laid out in different ways, and we have to try to get all of that into a consistent and common format so that our ECL code has one very consistent way to access the data. When we deal with what we call our metadata, or our user and our account or customer information, we don't have a static one-time event for this data that we do with our transactions. We have to be able to basically keep track of versions of the data. For example, in this diagram, we have a user record. And as you can see, the phone number and the date process is changing on this version of this J. Smith user. And every time we bring a new version in, we have to create a version on it so that we can go back in time and say, at this point in time, the J. Smith user record looked just like this. We also have to do a similar data truncation process for our cluster itself. Because we are ingesting so much data, we don't really have unlimited storage, so we have to make sure that we don't overutilize our storage, And we have our truncation process to do that as well. Lastly, we have security considerations. We have some SPII, we have PII data. We want to protect it. So we have various user authentication authorization mechanisms using Active Directory to control the communications between elements of the system, including users. We also need to protect the data at rest, so we have encryption that we use on our cluster, as well as our reporting tool server, so that the data is protected even if someone were able to get on the machine. Thank you. And now I'll pass it to Naweed.
Thank you very much, Marcus. And in case if you're wondering, we didn't plan on wearing the blue sweaters. It just happened. So before I get into product requirements, let me set the stage and explain to you where this application fit in the overall scheme of things within the organization. Right? Most of you know that LexisNexis have many products catering to many industries. And thousands of users use our products on a daily basis. And these products have built-in safety mechanisms, procedures, whatever you call for identity and access management. As an organization, our responsibility doesn't end there. In fact, IADP's responsibility starts from there. It is one of the main responsibilities of IADP to make sure that our products are being used by the right people in the right way and for the right purpose. And this application is one of the main tools that they use to ensure that. Now, there are many, I'm just going to stress on two major requirements that we have for the project. The first one is check every user event or user activity for fraud as soon as it is created. Why is it important? Because the sooner we identify a fraudulent or suspicious activity, the sooner we can act on it and prevent any damage it may possibly cause. The second one is create and deliver the reports requested by the investigators in the shortest time possible. So in any investigation for fraud or real-life crime, the most important thing is how soon can we provide this information needed by the investigators. So these are the two major requirements of the project. But what is the challenge? What is the challenge in front of us? What are we dealing with? We process more than 30 million transactions every day. The data that's coming in is from more than 60 data sources, and it's increasing by week, by month. Apart from the user events, we have to ingest metadata, lookup data, and also IP geolocation data, and create reports based on investigators' search requests. Now, as you are aware of, when you're dealing with such high volume and high velocity of data, there's always a risk that the data may get corrupted, or we get the data a bad feed from any data source. So one of the important requirements that we consider is to always maintain what we call a last known good state of the system so that we can always revert back to if we need to. Now, taking all these requirements into consideration, the business, the functional, and the operational requirements that Marcus talked about, the technology that we decided to use to solve this problem or to solve this challenge is HPCC systems. I don't have to tell much about it because Flavio already told you about it. High data processing capabilities, right? High scalability, low cost of development, low cost of maintenance. It's open source. What more do we need, right? Apart from that, what we liked about it is its simplicity, but simple but effective architecture. And also using the various components that it has in a flexible way. You will know what I am talking about when I say that you're using the components in a flexible way. This is a high-level architecture of the application. As you can see on the left-hand side, you get the metadata, IP, geolocation data, and the application transaction logs into the HP system. We perform data ingestion, fraud detection alerts, and the advanced searching and reporting. On the right-hand side is the web application the users or the investigators use to create their searches. And then we have the Elasticsearch, where we also store our metadata along with the HPCC. This Elasticsearch metadata is used by our web application. And once the investigators finalize the query or the search, that information is stored in the MySQL database, and HPCC systems are processed there, which reads that database and picks up the new queries and creates the reports and put it in the reports repository. So that's a very high-level view of this of the application architecture. Going a bit deeper into what exactly is happening on the HPCC system side, we get the metadata, we ingest it, and just to give you a brief overview of how the data is stored in HPCC, the file structure, as you can see, IADP metadata, we have account, IP, and the user data. And also, as you can see, we maintain multiple generations of or copies of that data. Because one of the requirements, if there is a bad data feed, we have to go back to the previous version. This is the way we do it, maintain three different versions. And similarly, the case with the IP geolocation data. Again, IP geolocation data is the similar format we follow. And the most important thing is the user and action logs. Even though these logs go through multiple steps, I'm going to highlight just the most important ones. Of course, the first one is data validation. We have to make sure the data that's coming in is good in the format that we expect it to be. If the whole feed or the each individual record that's coming in. Next one is data formatting. We need to format the data according to our requirements. Data enhancement. Here's where we link the data with the transaction data, with the metadata, and the IP geolocation data. Why we need to do that? Because it provides more insight for the investigators. We perform fraud checks. If we find any suspicious activity, if we see that the authentication logs or the transaction logs, there's something suspicious, we alert the required people. And then we build indexes. The indexes are both payload and non-payload. And I want to make one thing, point out one thing here. Each data feed has its own set of indexes. Even though the structure is same, the index or the index are totally on its separate files. Why we do that? I mean, if you imagine this as a data lake, imagine that each data feed is its own island. And again, this goes back to maintaining the last good state. What happens if we get a bad data feed from a data source? How soon we can, pick up our system? We can easily, if you do that, we can easily quarantine that bad data feed, fix it, and then put it back in the system without affecting the major functionality of the system. We can continue doing that. That's the first part of our requirement. The second stage is the reports creation for the users. So this is a web application that we have that uses Elasticsearch for building up the search, and that information is stored in the MySQL database. And there's a query process on HTTP side which reads this data from MySQL, creates the reports, and again pushes it back to the reports repository. Now, if you remember, I talked about flexible use of components, right? You must have seen this HPCC systems architecture diagram before. You see the data coming in, we have Thor, just like a normal, you see everywhere, which does the data ingestion and also the fraud detection. This is what we use. But on the right-hand side, you see the Thor Q2. Generally, you see a Roxy, but we are using a second Thor there, because that's what we need. And this flexibility of HPC systems, what makes it great. In conclusions, how did it help moving to HPC systems? The time taken to check every user event for fraud is reduced from hours to minutes. More exhaustive fraud detection. What I mean by that, we can add more different, we can check now for more different types of frauds. So earlier we couldn't do that. Faster report creation. Our investigators are having the information they need sooner than what they used to do. Earlier it used to take hours and sometimes days to get the information. But now it's reduced to minutes. New, more complex queries. It's also our investigators can now create much more complicated queries to get the information from. So these are some of the things that we want. But now, what's more important, what's exciting for the team, from the development, from the business analysts and everyone, is what we can expect in future. The fraud detection, as Andy talked about, currently it's a rules-based system. Now we can go to ML and AI. We can do many more things. So with power of HPC systems on our side, the only restriction is our imagination, what we can do. Thank you.
Doc.
Very good, great, great, guys. This is very good. Very good. So I hope this sparked some ideas. It's not just the general way they do it and how this has improved what they did before, but also the patterns that they use. Many of these patterns can be applied in many other places. So if you're using HPCC or you're thinking of a project for HPCC, some of these patterns that they use there, I think they're highly applicable. So talk to these guys. They know what they do, and they have used HPCC in ways that were not exactly the more traditional ways that we used somewhere else, right? And this is fortunately, this is quite common across the community where you find new applications and then you use it you apply it in a different way, and that gives you new capabilities that you didn't even know you could achieve with HPCC. But for the next presenter, I'll leave the clicker here as well. He's not just an experienced technologist, he's also a colleague and a friend of mine. He has also been my host to China in my last trip to China. And I should have brought the pictures in the Tiananmen Square and Forbidden City and Great Wall, which I didn't. So I want to welcome Yuin Chen. He's going to talk about using HPC systems for a completely new implementation of a business in a different geography, in a different country, with different ways of doing things with different requirements. This will give you a good perspective on what you can do from scratch using HPCC to build a complete new business. So please help me welcome Yuin Chen.
Good morning. My name is Yuin Chen. I'm very happy being here this morning. When I flew in from Beijing last night at the airport, my baggage almost lost. I was thinking that what if I wear the dirty clothes and show up in today's conference. But at last minute, I find my bag and I get to hotel midnight. I'm here in time. So very happy about that. Really appreciate the opportunity. I think I saw many eyes stare at my fashion show, right? That's a new fashion of my neck. This is actually an injury I got 2 months ago when I was training for my third Ironman. I was riding bike and then got in an accident. Without getting more scared of you, I'm being recovered very well. And doctor said, 1 more month, I will take this call off. Obviously, I can travel. The only thing is I cannot drive. I cannot turn my neck freely yet, all right? So set this aside, let's talk about China. HPCC systems expanding in this rapid big data market. And I will tell you what this market look like, what HPCC system has been doing, and what kind of accelerators we can do in China in the upcoming years. China is so different from us. It's 12 hours time difference. It's almost opposite side of us. So by raising your hand, how many of you visited China? Maybe about 10-ish. How many of you plan to visit China in the next year or so? I saw Vijay's hand. It is a different country. The country expanded a lot, and it's very difficult for me to share this market with you in a very short time period, but I think I can do it just from one angle, the big data market perspective. And I will share you with you from the three different views. First view is the macro view. 30,000 foot view, what the economy look like. We know China is world's second biggest economy in terms of GDP. But it wouldn't look like that 30, 40 years ago. If you look at the chart, 30, 40 years ago, the gap between US and the China economy is huge. Not until around 2000-2005, the development of the China economy took off. And now, someone even predict, in the next decade or so, China GDP will surpass US. With that, China has lots of number ones. I list some of them over here. Largest foreign exchange reserve, biggest exporter, and the number two as the importer, and I believe it will become number one in terms of imports because of the huge consumer market. Number of car sales, renewable energies, transportation. It's another area in China that's leading the world. The length of the high-speed railway. It's bigger than next 20 countries combined. When we talk about high-speed railway, it's not 100 miles per hour. It's over 150 miles per hour distance from New York to Atlanta will only take about 3-4 hours to complete. Highway, waterway, it's all leading the world. Communication is the area we will touch multiple times in this presentation. Number of internet users. Who want to make a guess how many users in China? It's about 1.54 billion, give you a clue. Over 800 million. We know our population, right? In US, it's about over 300 million. Over 800 million based on the 2018 stats using internet. And out of that, 98% people use internet via their mobile phone. Again, 10 years ago, the number wasn't like that. The red bar represents the number of users, total number of internet users. Orange bar represents total number of internet users use mobile phone. The gap in 2008 was quite big, and then it took off again, and 98% they use internet through mobile phone. There are challenges associated with China's growth. One of the challenges over here is the emission. Carbon dioxide emission in China grow dramatically as well, especially between 2000 and 2010. And then it's flattening out. The red line represents China's emission, the world's biggest as a country, but not per capita. With that, the country tried to find a solution. One of the solutions is use the electricity, powered car, EV. The funds probably a little bit small, but as you can tell, back to 2014, the number of charging stations in China is almost the same as US. But in 5 years, the black bar represents number of charging stations in China, and the white bar represents number of charging stations in US. As you see, there's a tremendous growth in China in the past just 5 years. And this is the prediction of EV car sales in China. Blue represents the number of China's, a number of car sales in China, and white represents the rest of the world. I talk about the macro view, 30,000 skyline view, and now we zoom into the city view. You may ask why we talk about the city, why don't we talk about the suburban? After all, many people living, and more people living suburban in China, just like us, right? But that's another difference between US and China. We like to live in suburb. LexisNexis Risk Solution headquartered in Alpharetta. I live in near Johns Creek. But in China, people like to move into city because that's where the activity and the actions and opportunities are. This is Shanghai 2019. Almost look like New York. A financial center in China, as well as East Asia. This is also Shanghai. 30 years ago. It's almost flat. In 30 years, it's transformed itself into a modern city. The before and after picture can show you how rapid this change is. Right now, the urbanization not only happens in those mega cities like Beijing, like Shanghai, it's getting to the second wave. The smaller cities, actually, it's not that small. Chongqing is one of them. It's the number five biggest city in the country. GDP size almost as big as Atlanta Metro. The growth is 6% in 2018, slightly lower than national average of 6.6%. 30 million people living over there and growing. And the city starts focusing on the AI and the smart city development. One of the conference they hosted this year is the Smart City China Expo 2019. That's where the opportunity is. That's where the country is going to develop into. Now, let's look at the company and the user view. What do people use and what the company look like, internet company look like in China. This is based on the Wikipedia stats. In 2018, top 10 internet companies, world's top 10, four of them come from China. IDC has the report. Top five mobile phone manufacturers or companies, including Samsung and Apple, also three of them from China, Huawei, Xiaomi, Oppo. How people use mobile phone in China? Why is it used? Probably I should say how people live with mobile phone or mobile apps in China. They use it every day, not only just make phone calls, text message, browsing, checking emails, right? This is the list of all major usage in China. Almost everyone uses that. Mobile payment. In big cities like Shanghai or Beijing, people don't use cash anymore. No credit card, because credit card requires a device to read a card, plus 2% of the fee. No cash. When you buy a bottle of water, your cash may be rejected by the vendor because there's no change. It's expected that you use the phone to make a payment. It's so convenient and free. Another example, food ordering and delivery. Think about our food ordering delivery, right? In China, it's a one app. You can search dozens of different restaurants, hundreds of different menu items from the mobile phone app, and when you place order, all the payments is included. Delivery will show up on your door, usually less than 30 minutes. How much people gonna charge you for the delivery fee? Most of time, less than $1. That's how convenient and low cost associated with those type of service. And that's why people over there live with their mobile phone. And the list go on. And it's essentially create a huge digital economy associated with mobile phone. How many of you heard about WeChat or Alipay? Half of you? Great, all right. Super apps, we call it super apps. Why we call it super apps? People literally open the app, can do everything. Everything on my left-hand side, right? You can do it in WeChat and Alipay and one app, solve all your problems. 800 million of users using it every day. Along with that, there are specialized apps. Some focus on travel, some focus on shopping, some focus on Uber-like of service, some focus on news. There's many, I only list a few. And when I say smaller app, it means not 800 million users, but probably 300 or 500 million users. That's what smaller means. CNBC said in 2018, China already generated 7.6 zettabytes data. In comparison, US is 6.9. In 5 years, it's going to be almost 50 zettabytes, and US is around 30. So that's the new digital economy look like and how people use it. Now let's talk about what the HPCC's journey in China. Without stealing the thunder from Jessica and Trish, this is the brand new streamlined website in Chinese version. HPCC started the journey around 2013 in China, partnered with Infosys, helped us launch the first HPCC system productionized in China, and the LexisNexis also started with POC around 2014. 2015, we formed the GenLex joint venture and eventually acquired early this year, 2019. We also started partnering with the Chinese e-commerce company to create the HPCC data lab. 2016, we provide the HPCC training to GenLex. I believe people in the room provide the training to the GenLex, some of them, by raising your hand. Appreciate it, right? You remember that, 2016, three years ago. 2017, we create the data clusters using e-commerce data, and then launched the first, LexisNexis launched the first HPCC Thor production in GenLex data center. 2018, create the improved scoring model and attributes, launched the Chinese version of HPCC system website. That was the previous version of this new streamlined version, and this year, we have full production HPCC system in China AWS. So that's the journey of HPCC system in China so far. And I will show you two use cases on how we use HPCC system in China. First is about the e-commerce data lab. We deploy one city data, it's Beijing, around 27 million users. 600 million orders, 1 billion order items. With that, we will be able to create the attributes, actually 25,000 attributes using Kale and Salt, improve the scoring data model. That was complete around 2017 and 2018. This is more recent example. GenLex Connected Car Initiative, built based on global telematics platform. In order for this global telematics platform run in China, we have to do significant changes. First, we have to load the roadmap. We also have to change the Google map into the local map because the Google is not accessible in China. We have to optimize SDK heavily because many different kinds of devices, Android devices in China that's available. And we also have to customize the HPC setup for China AWS, which is a different AWS from the one we are available in the global. With that, we were able to build a China version GDP and support Connected Car Initiative. Finally, let me share a series of China accelerators we can do. First will be the business accelerator. Doing business in China has never been easy. There are companies entering China like eBay, Google, Home Depot, Uber, and Amazon. E-commerce website is different from Amazon AWS. They enter in China and then decide to exit. And then Facebook, Netflix, PayPal, and probably more companies, they haven't decided to enter in China or not, or they decide not to enter in China. On the other hand, we have plenty of companies doing very well in China. Microsoft, starting 92, Walmart, Apple, Costco. LexisNexis, as I mentioned, started the joint venture in 2015 with GenLex. And the Amazon AWS started the China Amazon 2016. And most recently, Tesla and Salesforce announced their China operations 2019. As we noticed, most recent, starting 2015-ish, more and more technology companies get into China, and they like to grow with the China's digital economy. As LexisNexis, we also accelerate our China business by acquire GenLex fully in February this year. Second accelerator we can look at would be the big data AI community. Through the online and offline activities. The offline, similar to this event, right? This HPCC conference event, lots of, we can provide training, consulting, speaking, those will be the traditional method. However, the online would be very much different from what we do online here because of the tool that's available in China. On the left-hand side, all of those tools, only LinkedIn is the common LinkedIn as we use here. YouTube is not available. Google is not available. Twitter is not available. What else? Probably there's a long list of our common social media. Oh, Facebook, not available, all right? In China. With that, there's localized version have to use in order to reach the Chinese community. So that's the reality, and that's what we have to do. The third accelerator I want to talk about is the data analytics, or I call it a new generation of data analytics, based on the mobile phone. We can do a lot, use the mobile phone. Traditionally, we may collecting the data from the data source, we may buy data from the data source, right? But now we can generate the data ourselves, just like kinematics. Just use the mobile phone, we can create not only driving behavior, it can be a dash cam, dash camera. You can notice the crash, you can do the insurance claim. When we had fully developed a connected car, more possibility can be done use IoT integration, vehicle-to-vehicle communication, all powered, can be powered by AI and HPCC technology at the back end. So that's the new generation of data analytics is possible to be created in that huge data market. The last accelerator I want to touch on is the 5G and the IoT. I think all of us heard about the 5G, right? And that's a race already started. In China as of today, there are 350 5G operable stations already deployed, 10 times more than US. Based on the Bloomberg report, 2020 and on, 1/3 of 5G connections will come from China. So the chart will show you the orange is US, gray represent number of connections from China, and the blue is the rest of the world. China has already become the world's biggest coliseum for digital data gladiator. With 5G and IoT, this coliseum will only become many times bigger than today in the next 5-10 years. So our answer will be AI plus HPC system. And this will give us tremendous opportunities for new wave of data and a new wave of data services. In conclusion, I shared with you how this big data market looks like, some of challenges the company is actively seeking for solutions, and those challenges also represent opportunities for us. And I truly believe we can deploy a series of accelerators in China for the next wave of growth for HPCC system. If you have questions, feel free to stop me. And this is my WeChat and the LinkedIn link. And we can connect, and I'm happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Great talk. Thank you. So for our next talk, how many of you had breakfast this morning? Oh. OK. This is going to be a talk about biotech and HPC systems. That's the topic, but don't get out of a room, it's fine. You're not gonna have a problem with your breakfast. So for this next talk, I have Meng Han, who is one of our colleagues, have been working with HPCC for some time, and he has some exciting research, applied research, on the area of biotech and HPCC systems. I think this is an area that you will enjoy. Meng.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm so glad to be here. And after another two from IADP friends and from Yun's excellent presentation, they all came from a very high level scope of industry. And I am going to introduce will be a small sport of the research. And introduce myself. Thank you for the nice introduction. So my name is Meng Han. And to easily help you to remember me, I came from Inner Mongolia of China. So my name actually from same pronunciation of Mongolia. So Meng Han, I am a assistant professor working for the College of Computing and Software Engineering at Kennesaw State University, pretty nearby. And it's quite interesting, and I am the last one for the industry session this morning. And I'm a purely academia person, but I'm going to introduce a industry practice. So that I will like tell the story. And I hope I could be a good transition between the industry and academia in the next session. So the outline, so just to do a brief introduction, who we are, what we are doing, and the research practice from academia beginning to the industry practice. And I will definitely introduce a little bit of the HPCC, but not a lot. There are so many experts of HPCC. So first of all, introduce my lab. So it's a small team. Me, myself, cannot do a lot of things, but with the student help, with the collaborators, with a lot of friends, we can do much, much more things. So our lab's name is the Data-Driven Intelligence Research Lab. I think it may match Yun's like next generation data analytics. That is what we are doing. So we are majority working for the data science and artificial intelligence. Actually, it's still based on the machine learning, data mining traditionally, but we hope to plug the technology into the new, generation or solve some practical, interesting problem. And here, something I want to emphasize is the last sentence. That is, when I establish my lab, I hope as a research unit in a university, I hope the whole team could do something good. And we do get the freedom with the support of university. We want to help improve many aspects of people's lives. So that is what we are doing. And that is the biotech the beginning story of the biotech in that, the practice. So our scope is mainly working on the part of the data intelligence. Another part is data security privacy. So that pretty much our first theme of the presentation. And then with the support of HPCC, that is the beginning why we can touch the HPCC, because we are doing a bunch of work, particularly with data science, AI, data manipulation, manning and learning skills. HPCC did provide us a really good open source, good community, and good support to solve our problem. And we can focus on the algorithm development, theoretical, I mean, research, instead of the other thing. So we use other Hadoop, Spark, we can still complete some project, but with HPCC, we use less time and less cost to solve the problem. And since it is an industry practice, I will introduce the industry partner. This company is Omega Biotech. I don't know if anybody in our room knows this company. It is the top five, in some product, it's the top two company worldwide to provide the service for DNA test. We all know some other company working for DNA test for human. So we'll find out, I'm Chinese, so shall I get some other, blood from the old time, from other area? But this company actually produced more than 900 products, ranging from RNA insulation from plant and DNA extraction. And what they did is they will do the DNA extraction and help you to provide you the data of the DNA test. And this company also provides the microbiome gunt profiling kit and analyze the gunt microbiome. So that would be something, I am quite interested. And they also produce some products of that. This company just located in Norcross area, so maybe you don't know that, but they also have the site in Australia and some other countries. It's pretty huge, pretty low-key, and pretty nice company. And after that, I will ask you some of the questions, like the breakfast question. So we all know we're supposed to be the host, the owner of our body, but we all know 60% of our body actually is water. And besides the 60% of our body, the remaining is supposed to be the hardware of our body. So then we may be controlled by our heart, by our brain. But if you know such kind of fact, you will be, at least for me at the beginning, I'm so impressed. So actually, our heart is a small size. Our brain is around maybe 3 pounds. But if you look at the probiotics, it is a big amount. If you think about 60% is water, remaining in the 40%, actually it's count around, if I'm 100 pounds, actually I'm more than that, but that would be count more than 10%. So that is the big side of our body. And actually that do affect us a lot. And if you look at some of the study I will introduce further, so there are so many things be affected by the probiotics, and majority of them are staying in our gut. So the gut is very important to us. Some of you, in our room, some of you may be on diet. So when we're on diet, we hope we can reduce the weight, but you know what effect? Actually, it's still the probiotics, because our diet will change the distribution of them. The probiotics would change the whole healthy system. And some of the like joke or like the story tell, actually, we are not the owner. Instead, the gunk bacteria actually is the owner of ourselves. When we feel hungry, actually, they are feeling hungry. Then we have to looking for some food. So that really affects our life a lot. And then there are so many research papers discuss how and like the gut bacteria really decrease many things in the obesity in some other like a different aspect. Majority of the research study begin from like 5-10 samples of real human. And then they publish paper in Nature, Science, such kind of top, I mean, the level of the like a research publication. And then what is the measure? And another story. So there is maybe more interesting. So the young pool makes aged fish live longer. So you will think about if we really can change or improve or make optimize the probiotics of our eco, like a human ecosystem, that will really help us a lot. And that is my role. My role is data-driven intelligence. So with all this kind of interesting fact, we hope we can play some position. Back to the last sentence I mentioned. In Nature Science, such kind of really great publication, the study is conducted by the doctors. They conduct the human stuff, they conduct the research on it, but with very small sample. For me, as a data scientist or a researcher in this area, we hope to conduct this kind of research in a large like amount of data and solve the problem and provide more insight from the data. And here is a more like a recently like a study. So we'll say the probiotics is important, and there are big amount of these kind of bacteria worth to analyze, but it is not easy. There are so many data, and the size is the issue. It's not a big issue actually. The biggest issue is the complex. So the data is so complicated. So we'll say we actually, some like scientists, they try to develop the specific chips to solve the biotech problem. And the data is huge. We'll say there are around billions level, and there are like so many data, and the analytics is so complicated, and it will be very challenging. And that is our role, try to play. So our lab try to play a small role to analyze a small like a group of data of them. So actually, like I'm always interested, our team is always interested in many different, like a biotech related study, leverage the power of deep learning, machine learning, a bunch of technology we are familiar with. And early, actually, we leverage the Google Trends and the CDC data. We try to do a better, the flu prediction. That's the early beginning. And then we conduct the cancer prediction. And we'll say one of the authors actually is from the American Cancer Society in downtown area. So we are not expert in the domain, but we believe the expert in the domain could really tell us a lot of things worth to study. So we are still working on what we are doing. We won't do the cross-disciplinary, but we won't do it ourselves. We trust our partner, our collaborator, and solve the problem in a best way. And another work we did is actually it's accepted by the BMC Bioinformatics this year. So this study actually is like a kind of the another beginning with the gunk, like the bacteria. So actually we try to study the data for the mental disease. And if you notice in the previous several examples, the gunk bacteria really affect the mental disease. And that is not just the hungry issue, but maybe some other depression, a bunch of things. And from that study, we analyzed a big amount of data and leveraged the power of the deep learning. We did notice something. So the most famous Alzheimer, so we all know that is a big, like a challenge for human, as well as more and more aged people like coming out. From our study, we are not responsible for the like a doctor aspect. From the statist aspect, we really notice for Alzheimer, there are like a study, education, history, bunch of other factors. We may think a fact, but actually they are not, at least from our study. But what we notice is one thing will help us really lose our memory. That is like overweight. So overweight become one of the most significant factor we detect. I mean, like kind of we verified really affect losing the memory. And another fact, maybe you think about alcohol, tobacco, that kind of thing, but from our study, they didn't affect. But another interesting fact we notice is we lose our partner, the wife or husband, during the middle age. So it is a significant result we discovered from our study. So lose your partner or your loved person would really hurt. That is a mental attack. And that would be something we noticed in that research and we reported out in the publication. That is like a beginning of the mental disease. And then we notice more. So actually I'm like a quite interesting involved in the community and society volunteer nonprofit work. Then I participate with the True Love for Hope. It's an organization help the kids for the mental disease. Then when I went into that area, I noticed it actually just exactly follow what I'm researching in. So that is the autism. So we'll see it is a big hurt for a lot of children. And a lot of study actually for now has detect the disease really affect by the gut bacteria. So that is actually, finally we go back to our industry practice. So we'll say there are so many factors, but one of the most factor will be the diet. In another way, we'll say it's probiotics really affect the mental health of the children. And how to improve. So if we think about the gut bacteria, it is something hard to change. Actually, it is something really easy to change. We only need to eat some probiotics. Good thing help the children become better and recover. So here is just a number from for the estimate autism and in the past couple of years. That's because the new environment, because the internet, because the mobile, that really make the mental disease even hard. And that it make the whole ecosystem even challenge. And our project actually in this part is a project we are conducting. So with the generous support from the Omega Biotech company, they provide me an environment, allow me to conduct research for a project for 2 to 3 years. We are planning to have 3 phases. The first phase, we are going to conduct about 40 children's gun test. And the company provide me all the support to do this kind of test and bring me the data to me. And we did perform a good privacy preserving methodology before process the data. And we care about the privacy. So then most of all, that could be and that would be so far the most comprehensive, largest data set because we'll conduct more than 300 different bacteria within the gut of this case. And you know, the biggest challenge is for kids, each kid have different background, their family, right? Then whether eat the probiotics will help, it will help. But how to optimize the happiness best, we need to customize each of the treatment. So for us, it's like we will collect their data pre-test and post-test and try to analyze their distribution of the bacteria. Then we can help them to plan some probiotics. It's kind of like a food plan even. So then we can help them powered by AI to solve their health care problem in this case. It will be a long-term process. And then we hope we can really get some good results. And the Omega Biotech company always support many of the academia, institute. And right now, they truly support me, a faculty from Kennesaw State University. And then go to the HPCC process. As I mentioned, we need to keep collecting the data from this kind of case. And when we get the data, we notice the data amount is big, and the pipeline how to solve the problem is a challenge. In that case, like previously, the normal, procedure of the company is they send out the kits. It's like if you did any kind of DNA test, you just purchase the kits, give a blood, a small sample of the blood or something, they will do the test. Previously, in Omega Biotech, they performed the same thing from New York, California, UK, different country worldwide, and then can ship out a kit, and then you provide the blood and ship it back. And the data will come back and go to the manual analytics. There will be one guy collect each case and manually input everything into the system and keep track for each case. That is a normal thing. And once the sample arrive there, the company, they can perform all the tests and detect and analyze the DNA or RNA, that bunch of thing. But for now, that is the practice before. For us, is as an academia person, fortunately, get opportunity to work with industry. And then we notice it is very inefficient. So we hope to help them to solve the problem as well as solve my own problem. It's research. We want to conduct research in a more efficient way. Then that is the early stage. So we will do a Kafka message server. We save the money. We do not need to hire another specific staff to solve the problem anymore. And we actually provide a way, allow them to call the API to get the results. We still need to collect the sample back, but we actually can collect other, the profile data, bunch of other data, even tracking their debt information to see what would be the best strategy to solve the problem. And within the HPCC, the support of HPCC, actually we got the ECL program and we can pass the data, particularly the raw data, into our biology data side and do the analysis. So that is the majority part of the HPCC practice, but that do help a lot, us a lot. Previously, it takes more than 1 month. For now, it takes, maybe less than 1 week for particularly instance. Sometimes it takes days for us to either collect the data and respond the client with their latest update. And HPCC help us a lot. And what is the benefit of HPCC? Why we choose HPCC? As I mentioned, HPCC is easy used, as everyone know, and all the experts here. But we really enjoy the time when we are using to processing our data. And also the other expert mentioned, so the HPCC watch, bunch of other things. And we can do easily to do the high demand storage, annotation, and analysis. As a practice industry, right now the system is implemented and in production in the company, Omega Biotech. And they are testing, and they also give me some feedback, so how good, how bad, and what is something we can improve further. Hopefully, it's just the beginning. This year is the first year, and our project, the mental disease project is going to conduct them for another 2 years. So hopefully in another 2 years, we can report more results. And hopefully that kind of result can help us, can help the society back to the vision of our lab. Hopefully all the effort of our team could really benefit the society and benefit the human lives. That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Han. What a very interesting yet eye-opening use case. You know, two things I thought I would never see together is gut profiling and HPCC systems. But hey, we're breaking grounds. But it's amazing work. We value our relationship with Kennesaw State University. and your lab. We're doing a lot of things there. We just finished up a hackathon. So just keep it coming and count on us to help you with this continued medical research. So I think after a talk on healthy digestion seems to be the perfect segue into our first break. I don't know about you guys, but I'm going to go for the apple and a probiotic. So, but whatever you choose to indulge in, thank you again to our gold sponsor, Infosys, for providing our coffee breaks today. And take this time to visit our exposition area. Our interactive expo is now open. You guys are getting up and going. I'll talk fast. We have a challenge going on, okay? So in your attendee bags were these sheets. If you stop by all of the tables, get this signed, return it to the registration desk for a Starbucks card while supplies last. So use this time wisely, stand up, stretch. Our live stream audience, don't feel left out. We'll be streaming videos and footage of the expo area, so keep it up with hashtag HPCC Summit. Stand up, stretch. We'll see you guys back here at 10:30. Thank you. Welcome back. Hope everyone enjoyed the break and browsing through our exhibit area. Who is in the leaderboard position right now? Anyone in here? Who holds the top spot? Are they still out there using the curl bar? Okay. Well, as mentioned earlier, you'll have more time to spend there this afternoon, but now we are moving into our academic track, where you get to hear from our university partners on how they are leveraging our HPCC system platform in a variety of ways. So did you know that through our HPCC systems academic program, we have awarded over $3 million in grants and sponsorships, yeah, to help support our academic community. And this is in a variety of ways. We support them through research, internships, hackathons and workshops. And through this collaboration, we have published and written over 50 papers. Over 30 students have gone through our HPCC Systems internship program, of which we've hired quite a few. So we were really proud of that. So our first speaker from Clemson University is a PhD student from the College of Information and Computer Science, and she just completed her second year in our summer internship program. Here to discuss her work on using the text vector bundle and common bag of words algorithm in text mining, please welcome Ms. Farah Alshanik.
So, hello everyone. I am Farah Alshanik. I am from Clemson University. I'm a PhD student. Today I'm going to talk about how to extract. Today I'm going to talk about how to extract the domain-based common words using the high-dimensional representation of the text. So the outline of the talk will be as following. Yeah, what is the other one? Okay. The outline of the talk will be as following. First, I will introduce the domain-based words in general and the stop words, which is the standard stop words list that many of the researchers use. Then the definition of the domain-based common words and why we need to extract these words. After that, I'm going to talk about the text vectorization. What is the text vectorization and why I use the text vectorization in my project. After that, I will talk about the domain-based common words using the text vector bundle, which is an HPCC machine learning bundle. Also, I will talk about the continuous bag of words, which is an algorithm that it's a version of the word-to-vec algorithm that predicts the center word based on the words that surround it. Then the domain-based common words methodology, which is our methodology that we built as an internship project. Then the case study and how we test our methodology by using the classification and the topic modeling. So today we are living in the era of big data, where we have a huge amount of data set that coming from different domains and various vectors. For example, we have medical data, political data, and the industrial data set. And in order to discover the hidden structures and to find the insights inside these data set, we need to pre-process the data first. The text cleaning is a crucial step in the text pre-processing. And the stop words removal, or what we called the stop word reduction, is an important step in the text cleaning. This is very important step because it saves a huge amount of the text indexing. By removing the noise words, these words that are non-predictive and non-discriminating, it does not add any value within particular context. So many of the researchers use the standard stop word list to remove these words, the noise words. For example, we have the English standard stop word list that have the words like, is, and are, the. The problem with these words or this list it's general and applied to any context, regardless the domain. However, we have many domain-based common words which different from one domain to another and does not have any particular value within particular domain. By removing these words, we will reduce the size of the corpus. For example, the word protein will be a domain based in a set of collection talking about medical data, but not in a set of collection describing political issues. So we use the text vectorization. The text vectorization is a method of encoding the contextual meaning as a vector of numerical data. So we will encode the meaning of the words. Which is the power of the text vectorization is its ability to encode the meaning of the words. So the meaning of a word is closely associated with the distribution of the words that surround it in coherent text. We can do that by implement or represent each word by a vector of n dimension. So the vectors are coordinate in a space. For example, the 3D vector can represent a coordinate in a 3D space, and the n-dimensional vector can represent a coordinate in n-dimensional space. And the text vector are typically between 20 to 1,000 dimension. So we use the text vector bundle, which is a HPCC machine learning bundle, in order to do that. This bundle implements the continuous bag of words algorithm. This algorithm can predict the centered word based on the word that's around it. So it encodes the meaning of the words. The text vector bundle finds the coordinate for each word so that it's close to all words with similar meaning and distant from all the words with dissimilar meaning. And also, by represent the word or the sentences in the corpus, we can use these vectors as input or feature for any machine learning algorithm. So in our project, we use the idea of analysis of both the vector similarity and the multidimensional scaling demonstrate that there is a significant semantic information carried in this vector. So we build our hypothesis, which said that the candidate domain-based words are those words that have the shortest distance from the centroid by averaging the word embedding. So we use a continuous bag of words, which is the text vector bundle. As we said, that it's able to predict the current target word, which is the center word, based on the word that surrounds it. So if we have an example like the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, and we want to predict the word in the center, which is the fox, we can use a window of size, for example, here 5, to do that. So we will use two words before the fox and two words after that. So here represents its ability to find the center word based on the word that's around it. So the text vector bundle uses a continuous bag of words, which is represent or have a particular type of a neural network. It has three layers, which is the input layer in the left, the middle layer, and the output layer. The input and the output layer have many neurons based on the number of words in the vocabulary, and the middle layer have number of neurons based on the dimensionality. After we apply the continuous bag of words on the corpus, we were able to represent each word by a vector of n dimension, so it's called the word embedding. So then we build our methodology that first find the center of the corpus by averaging the word embedding, then using some distance matrices to find the distance between each unique token in the corpus and the centroid. So here the methodology in detail. So first we use the text vector bundle to produce a numeric vector for each unique token in the corpus. Then we find the centroid of the corpus by averaging the word embedding. Then we use the distance matrices like the Euclidean distance and the cosine similarity to find the distance between the centroid and the words in the corpus. Then we sort the distance in ascending order. And here we found that the words that have shortest distance are the domain-based words. So we pick the N words with the shortest distance to be the domain-based words. Here are the steps. So first we have the corpus. Then we tokenize the corpus. In the text pre-processing, we didn't eliminate any words. Only we convert the words into lowercase and remove some special character. We didn't remove also the standard stop words. Then we apply the text vector bundle, represent each word by a vector of 100 dimension. Then we found the centroid of the corpus, find the distance between the words and the centroids, then sort the distance in ascending order, and after that we can pick N numbers to be a domain-based common words. The case study that we used in order to test our methodology, we use the PubMed dataset because it is available publicly and it provides a huge amount of the citation. It has more than 26 million citations for biomedical literature from midline life science journals and online boxes. We use around 92,000 abstracts from two journals, which is the Journal of Bacteriology and the Biochemical Journal, in order to apply the classification and the topic modeling in these abstracts. So when we apply the text vector bundle on the abstracts, we were able to represent each word by a vector of 100 dimension. This is only a small example. Each word represented by a vector of 100 dimension. Then the word that have similar meaning in the corpus will have a similar vector representation. Then after we applied our methodology to find the domain-based words, this is the top 24 domain-based words after sorting. As you can see here, we have the words from the, first we have the words from the standard or the general stop word list, which is the word like or not this word of. But in the bottom, you can see we have a word patients. These words, because we are talking about medical data set, so, and these two journals, so the patients will be a domain-based words. And here it's more clear, we have words like cell, treatment, found, level, and protein. Those only the top 24 domain-based words. So we use the classification and the topic modeling in order to test our methodology before eliminating the domain-based words and after eliminating. So we use a random forest classifier to test the methodology before and after. So we picked a random forest classifier because it can handle a large number of records and a large number of fields and work well using the default parameter. Also, which is important, it scales well on the HPCC system cluster. Then we apply the continuous bag of words, which is the text vector bundle, on the sentences in the abstract to represent each sentence with a vector of n dimension. Then we use these sentences as a feature to the random forest. And we supply the data into training and testing, 80% training and 20% testing. Then we convert our data to the form that used by the machine learning in a machine learning bundle in the HPCC. And we separate the independent and the dependent variables. So we have the abstracts and we have the journal names. We want to predict the journal names from the abstracts. So this is the accuracy of the random forest classifier before and after eliminating a set of the domain-based words. As you can see here, we have accuracy around 50% when we didn't eliminate any words. Then by eliminating around 5,000 words, we will able to enhance the accuracy. So it's increased by 3%. And also, this is the precision and the recall before and after eliminating the domain-based words. Also, it's enhanced a little bit. Also, we use the topic modeling to test the methodology. So the topic modeling able to identify the set of topic in documents, in a set of documents or a set of collections. We use the LDA, which is a popular tool to do that. It's able to identify the distribution of the topics in a set of documents. So here an example of three topics before and after eliminating 1,000 domain-based words. As you can see for the first topic, we have the words like cells, human, protein, expression, DNA, does. So all of these words are domain-based words because, again, we talk about medical data. But if you can see for after eliminating the domain-based words, the first topic here we have oxygen, surgery, weight, resistance, mice. So here the topic more clear. This is my talk about making some surgery on the mice. And also for the other topic, the second topic, it has many domain-based words, so it does not able to express the topic. But after eliminating the domain-based words, the topic's more clear. So as a conclusion, we developed a new method to automatically extract the domain-based words using the text vector bundle, which implements the continuous bag of words. So the words that have a shortest distance from the centroid by averaging the word embedding will be the domain-based words. Then we increase the accuracy of the random forest by 3% for this experiment, and we are planning to do more experiment and increase the number of abstracts. Then, as we know, our methodology is the first that utilizes the high-dimensional representation of the word to find the domain-based words. As a future work, we will test the domain-based words on other journals from PubMed. Also, we are planning to use different datasets. Then we will test the domain-based methodology using other classifier, like the naive Bayes, support vector machine, logistic regression, and other deep learning classifiers. Also, we will apply our methodology on the full text of PubMed and compare it by using the full text and the abstracts. And thank you.
All right, thank you, Farah, for sharing your work and all your contributions to our machine learning library. And where's Kevin Wilmoth? Is he nearby? Here you go. Kevin and Roger, I know both of you have been involved with helping Clemson University students in machine learning projects, so well done and thank you. All right, so up next, the area of sports analytics and science is somewhat new to us, but thanks to our collaboration with NC State University, we've been able to get exposure to this space. First, if you remember the NFL Victory Forecast Project, and with this year, Athlete 360. So here to tell us about how they're using HPCC systems to make sure their athletes are performing at their greatest, please welcome from NC State University, Professor of Computer Science, Dr. Vincent Free, and Data Scientist of the Strength and Conditioning Team, Christopher Connolly.
Which one? Oh, green. Hi. Thanks a lot, Trish, and thanks, Flavio. And before I get started, I just want to say I really enjoy coming here. I think this is a great event, and every year it gets better, and so thanks to Trish and Jessica and everybody who puts that on. But also, I get to hear all the great things that you're doing, and I really was impressed with your with the advances that we've done in HPCC. I need to go look at the new website when it comes up. But the best thing of all of this is I really enjoy talking to you guys. You guys are creative, and you're intelligent, you're fun, and you're nice people. I don't know, a lot of conferences, they're not as nice as this. I don't know, something about, I guess, being in the American South makes everybody happy. But what we're doing here is we're working in, I've been working, talking with the strength coaches at NC State for a couple of years, and when I first got them, they were saying they had a problem. And so the problem is they have athletes, and there's a lot of data on this that you can collect on these athletes. And so they need to be able to take care of this data and be able to manage this data. And so it comes from a lot of different sources. A typical way is spreadsheets, because the barrier to entry on a spreadsheet is pretty low. You can pretty much learn how to drive a spreadsheet pretty quickly, and so you can put a lot of stuff in a spreadsheet. But there's limited analytics that you can do on it. I mean, you can do stuff by row and column, but you can't really get deep into it. And so I've seen some pretty impressive spreadsheets. The first one that I saw had over 500 columns of data. This guy was doing some lacrosse data, and he had over 500 columns of data, and it wouldn't load on the first machine I tried to load it on. But anyway, it's one way to do it, but it's not the best. And they
collect data from workouts,
and the athletes might do some workouts and do some number of reps, and we'll take that data. We also collect data from competitions, but during the game day, you want to figure out what they did and their stuff and data. And then we get it from a variety of sources. So one of the common sources you might imagine, many of you probably track your heart rate daily with your either your Fitbit or your smartwatch or something like that. You can watch it. Some people are still in the 20th century. So we can track that. And so we have these devices that we can talk about. And Flavio talked about how IoT has a connector for Fitbit in this. So we have those collections. And we also have a lot of instrumented equipment. One of them is out in the lobby, and we'll try to set that up. We didn't set it up between the break this time because we're getting mic'd for the talk. But after that, we'll set it up. And you can see one of the devices we use to measure athlete the exercise and the performance of an athlete. And I'll tell you that Flavio was on the leaderboard, number one on the leaderboard for most of yesterday with that. But we do this measurement. So this is the problem they have. They have this data, and they have a lot of data, and they want to do something useful with it in order to increase the athlete's performance, or to increase the recovery from injury, or to detect an onset of an injury. So what we decided to build was an athlete management system. So there's a lot of athlete management systems out there already. The space is pretty fractured and still trying to be defined. But there's nothing that quite does what the strength coaches wanted it to do. So we set out to build an athlete management system. And the goal of this is to take this data, which comes from all kinds of different places, and bring it all into one place so that I don't have to go, so that the coach who doesn't want to be a data scientist, Chris is different. Chris, I think he's reached a great sweet spot here. He's an exercise scientist who wants to be a data scientist, and I think that's a great sweet spot and a good combination. But most strength coaches want to be strength coaches, and so they don't want to have to learn how to use ECL and things and take the advantage of that. But what we want to do is collect it all in one place. So you go one place to find out everything you want to know about your data. Then we want to do some simple, straightforward analytics, like just what was your average velocity? What was your average heart rate? How long, how much weight have you, how has your weight changed over time during the season? So we want to be able to do that. But then we want to do some more interesting stuff. And this is where it's really getting exciting, and here's where we get to leverage a lot of the HPCC tools, is we want to be able to do predictive analytics. Like, one of the most important things I think to do would be predict onset of injuries. So if you could figure out that somebody's not doing well and sit them for a while, or give them less exercise, and make sure that athlete can stay healthy for the whole season, that'd be fantastic. So what a athlete management system has, it has four components. It has this one which we call the person, which is just, we have to be able to handle logins and distinguish between coaches and players and data scientists and staff and things like that. Very, very mundane thing that almost any website would have. But then we have what we call assessments. And we have an assessment is anything you want to measure on an athlete. So this has to be of highly configurable data type. And so we have a very straightforward way of building extensible assessments that we collect on all our athletes. Next thing we want to do is we want to report on that. The third component is to build reports that extract the assessment data from there. For example, one assessment might be to take the weight of an athlete. And so what we want to do is we dump in the weight every, let's say we weigh them every day. Well, then a report could be, let's look at their weight over time. or we can look at the, you know, the difference in their weight over time, or how and stuff like that. So that's an example of a report. So we're going to build a whole bunch of reports. Again, this is configurable and customizable. So the next thing we want to do is we want to build connectors. And we talked about, Flavio talked about connectors and how you can extract connectors from data streams out there. And so that's the idea, is that the connectors will create one or more assessments as they start to fetch data from that. So these are the four components that are in this thing. And we've taken an approach to build this as a, we wanted to release this as an open source project because we think that there's a lot of value to open source software. And so this is going to be an open source project. We haven't made it available to anybody yet because it's not quite ready to be commented on yet. But we're going to do it. And so these are the four components. And well, there's actually five components. The fifth component is really the advanced analytics. And what are you going to do with this assessments that you find? You're going to talk about assessments. And so for that, I'm going to let Chris tell you what he did on his summer vacation.
Okay, so with our athletes, we have plenty of different ways to collect data, but with all these different ways, all these different angles that we want to look at, kind of what affects them on a daily basis for their ability to be able to perform day in, day out, we have to find different ways to collect that data, different ways to frame that data. So we have three different types of data here. You can see a few different devices. Obviously, one of them is the one that is out there, the gymware device that'll pick up velocity of movements and stuff. Some of the other ones will give us other dimensions of what's happening. So under the category of readiness data, this is going to be basically the type of stuff that we're collecting most frequently. It's going to give us the idea of what's happening usually on the day-to-day basis with this athlete. How are they trending compared to their kind of normal state? So for some of the stuff on there, just a simple readiness questionnaire. So first thing they do when they wake up in the morning is they're going to answer these questions on how they're feeling, how they slept, are they sore, are they fatigued? And then we can take that and then use that to kind of frame the past couple days and what happens after that point. So with the force decks, which is our force plates, we'll usually do stuff like vertical jumps on those, a couple different other tests as well. And then with the Nordboard, similar to a force plate where you can see there with the little hooks on the back of the platform, they'll do a Nordic hamstring curl. Another way to measure force output with the hamstring, so we can kind of, especially with this soccer population, we can get an idea of, you know, how well they're staying up to kind of their normal capacity with their hamstring force. If they're dropping, then maybe we need to look at that and see, manage their load going forward. Then with the training load data, we want to be able to look at how much work they're doing on a daily basis. So another questionnaire that's done after their sessions on the field in the gym, they will rate how hard that session was, how demanding it was for their upper body, lower body, and kind of break it down to give us an idea of how that affected them. We have our GPS devices that will give us the idea of how much work they're doing on the field, how much distance they're covering, how fast they're running while they're doing that, what their heart rate is, and then being able to really dive into that when looking at the raw data, giving it context with our summary data, and then taking sessions from the gym as well. So when they're lifting in the gym, being able to look at the sets and reps that they're doing, the loads that they're doing it with, and then being able to take that all in and say, you know, how much of an effect is this particular session going to have on them? Because if they're already dead from practice and games, we don't want to make them more dead from lifting. So the performance data is how we track that change over time. So from there, we're able to then take some of the same devices as before, but look at it through a different lens and really say, all right, well, if they started the season here and we're trying to make improvements or maintain performance, what do they look like at the end of the season? Or when they come in to start after an off season, when they started that off season, they come back for the next season, are they in the same area? Did they fall off a bit? You know, did they do their summer training or not? We can take these different points to say, all right, where are they at now? Where do we want them to be? How do we keep them there or get them to where we want them to be, and use these data points to help us kind of understand where we are in that process? So just as an example of the force plates and how we use this, so through this, you know, just a simple vertical jump that we can do quickly at the beginning of a lift or before they go out to practice to get an idea of how they're jumping that day, we may not even use measures such as vertical jump because there's factors that can affect what their vertical jump number is in terms of jump height that may be things that will change their mechanics to try and get them to perform the same way. So someone might come in, jump numbers on a really good day, and then on a bad day, jump the same jump height, but the way that they actually achieve that is different. So by looking at different angles of the data, looking at their mechanics while they're doing it, we can decide whether or not their strategy is changing and if that's affecting the way they're performing their jump based on whether they're fatigued or not feeling good or feeling really good. So here's the Nord board again, doing basically as slow as you can go down until gravity beats you and then making sure you don't hit your face on the ground. But we can assess how much force they're able to put out with their hamstrings and maintain through that motion so that if they are fatigued, if it's been a really rough training block for them, we can see that show up here. They're not going to perform as well. They're not going to maintain that force. And we can adjust their training going forward so that we don't overload them. And then another example here with the gym wear that we're using outside, just tracking the velocity of a movement. Another way to make sure that we don't want to always be manipulating the load to try and get more out of an athlete. So another way we can look at that is the velocity. If they can perform the movement faster with the same load, then they're going to be more powerful. They're going to be performing better. So if over time we're doing these exercises with similar loads and they're able to move it faster, we can assume that they are on the right track. If they're not able to move as fast, then it may be a down day for them. We may need to adjust the loads to make sure that the effort level is kept to where we want it to be. And again, they're not being overloaded. So how we set up our system within HPCC systems is we want to be able to pull that data from all the different data sources that we have and bring it into that one place. So finding a way to get all of our data from our separate places, from all the different devices, and then bring that to a local place where we can then be able to upload that to our landing zone and then spray that into the cluster to start the work. And then from there, we created our programs to, you know, lay out the data, decide what each piece of data is going to be, what all the data types will be from all the different sources so that we can make sense of it and learn how to run it through the most efficient way and then be able to have everything in the right place to be able to interact with whatever other data it needs to. And then once we have gone through and done any aggregations or manipulations on the data to get any added information that isn't already in the raw data, then we can run through that process as well. Eventually then we'll kind of model the data to where we want it to be for any visualizations we're going to give to the coaches and then be able to then despray that back out and start to work on getting those graphs and stuff working so that when we go back to a coach, we can give them kind of the simplest, most straightforward view of what happened for that day or what's happening over time so that we can quickly get the message across to them, you know, for them to help get as much information as possible to make the decisions going forward on if they need to make any changes for certain athletes or if they need to change their plan for training or kind of the focuses of their training going forward into the next game or into the postseason. So just as a quick example of how we go through some of the questionnaire data and how we start from just a simple kind of input from the questionnaires to how we get to kind of an endpoint visualized report for a coach, starting out with just the regular layout for some different questionnaires, just simply the way it comes in from the start. This is kind of an example for the readiness questionnaire, how we lay it out, how we did kind of get the right data types in there. And then from there, our goal is to then be able to add context to it and join it together with the training load questionnaires so that we can start to build out the necessary data set we need to make the visualizations possible. So from there, we have to start adding in other things that can add pieces of information that will help us understand the data better. So in this case, we're looking at the questionnaires, and then from there, we want to make sure that since this is an everyday thing, we want to make sure that we're not missing any data for the athletes. So it's going to happen where athletes wake up that morning and they don't fill out their questionnaire even though they're supposed to. So there's going to be gaps in the data that aren't supposed to be there, and that's not going to give us an idea of what's actually happening with that athlete. So one way we're trying to get around that now may not be the best thing forever, but for now it's kind of the way we're approaching the problem, is create a median value based off of their data from, you know, X amount of days beforehand, and then fill those empty spots with that data. So what we're doing is taking a date file, which is also what we use to get the game day kind of information, or the day type for each day in the week. So we relate each day in the week to where they are in respect to their last game and their next game. From there, we can use these dates to make sure that we have that categorized value there, but we can also say, all right, well, this, all of these dates are supposed to be in this data set. If we're missing a date, then we know we didn't get their data for that day. We need to fill it with that median value, so that if we're looking at trends over time, we don't get a gap in that trend. From there, we'll then bring in all the different other things, such as athlete IDs, because if we're trying to be working with this data, we aren't going to be sharing out names and all that kind of information all over the place, so we can use unique IDs for each athlete. We can pull in all different sorts of information such as their position they play, and different pieces like that. Eventually, you know, what team they belong to and stuff like that once we branch out. But for now, it's still just the soccer teams. So from there, bringing in all these different pieces that are giving context to the data, bring in the different pieces that will allow us to be able to filter it in different ways once we do get to the visualization point. And then from there, figure out how else we want to frame just the regular input data. So for now, we've only had the inputs that they give each day. And now we want to get an idea of other ways to look at that trend over time. So now we go through the data set and we find some aggregates for a 2-day previous rolling average and a 4-day previous rolling average. So the idea here is that we look at the current day data point, and then we look at the trend from the past 2 days and then the 4 days before as well. So looking at kind of extended time periods beforehand, give us an idea of, all right, here's where they are at this point in time, here's where they were the past couple days, another slight bigger view. Is there a difference in those trends? Are they trending up? Are they trending down? Where are they compared to the rest of their teammates? In a sense like this, it's hard to make that sort of idea, because with people and their subjective view of how they feel, it's very hard to make comparisons between people. But we can see in general if the team is trending up or down, is this athlete falling into that trend, and then dive into their kind of individual responses. And then the big view of, all right, so on a typical day of training for soccer, you can see plenty of different drills, plenty of different ways that they approach how they're trying to accomplish their goals for that training session and how they're trying to plan going forward for a game. So as you can see in these couple drill layouts here, none of them really make sense when you just look at them. It's chaos. They're all over the place. You'd never know what the heck is happening. You just see a bunch of dots all over the field. Don't know what they're going to be doing. So in general, if you're just looking at a soccer practice or you're looking at the plan of a soccer practice, you have no idea what's going to happen, what they want to happen. So our goal with a lot of these data pieces is to be able to make sense of what's happening. If the coaches have certain goals for what's going to happen for certain drills or a certain practice, we want to be able to go back to them and tell them whether or not they met those goals, whether or not the intention of that session was met, and if it wasn't, then, you know, what can we do to make sure that when they go out and do the next training session, that their goals are met. So from there, that's where we kind of generate how we visualize the data. So here you can see a bit of a dashboard setup in Redash. So this is kind of populated through some tables that we pulled into a place called ClickHouse. Everything was from the data that was processed in HPCC. So once we get to the point where all the data is processed and we have it all ready to go to be visualized, that's when it then leaves HPCC, but everything we want to be done with the data is done within there. So now we can take that data, we can be able to frame what's happening in that practice in a way that the coach can get the most information out of it. Be able to say, all right, well, you know, the goal of today was to be able to get to, you know, 80% of what they would be covering in a game. In this drill, we wanted about 80% of the intensity of a game. Then we can go back to them and say, all right, well, comparing this data to where they are during the games, you met or didn't meet that, you know, and if you didn't, then here's something we can try and implement the next time to make sure we do meet that. So again, some of the next steps, like Vince had said before, We want to be able to now model out the data so that we can start to create some predictive analysis on this data, run some deeper statistical testing, dabble in the machine learning libraries a little bit to start to use our data as it continues to grow and get an idea of, can we start to use that to say, all right, if this athlete is on this particular trend, can we expect them to be, you know, X percent ready to perform when they get to their next game? If that's not where we want it to be, what can we do in the next few days leading up to that to try and you know, make their prediction better, make their forecast a little bit better so that when they get to game day, they're, you know, as much prepared as possible to perform at their highest level. Because again, the end goal here is to get kind of as many different views of what's happening on a daily basis with this athlete to be able to say, you know, we have as much of an understanding as possible for what's affecting their ability to perform so that we can try and either manipulate those things or help them improve those things as much as possible so that when they need to be performing at their best, that they are ready to be able to do that. And then again, one way of doing that is helping the sport coaches plan out their day as well, because not only are we doing the stuff in the gym, but we can help them kind of gain information on how they can improve what they're doing with the athletes out on the field, or how they kind of plan for a game day. So what is the best way, or how are we gonna get the most information out of the data that isn't already apparent, and then create a way to kind of provide that information in a way that's gonna be the easiest for the coaches to understand and make decisions going forward on how to, again, be able to improve the ability for these athletes to perform when they need to be at their best. So that's it for us today. If you have any questions or you wanna chat anymore, we'll be right outside at Expo Table 100. We'll set our little gym wear up again to do the bicep curls. And you can come by, ask us any more questions about how this project is kind of developing. And we have the poster for kind of a deeper dive into what we're doing with the GPS data and how we're trying to use that to help inform the coaches and their decisions they're making around a practice and how they plan that out. But other than that, yeah, thank you.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Vince and Chris. It's such a fun and compelling use case of the platform and how you guys are using it in your project. And now we know the secret of Thor and how we can use that to improve our own workouts. So you had a number of mentors because this was such a fun project. Everyone wanted to help you. So thank you to Raja, and where's Raja? I saw him earlier. Thank you to Raja, Lily, and Arjuna for working with Chris and Vince on this project for the summer. So definitely, like you said, stop by their booth, and they have a friendly competition going on. You have to, somebody's got to knock out Flavio in the number one top spot. Come on. And then you can test your own strength against Thor. All right, so for the next two talks, we're going to step back from the techie details and hear how our sponsorship funds are helping to support two very important programs. First up, he is one of two speakers today from Florida Atlantic University. He is the iRise2 Mentoring Program Coordinator from the FAU Center for Autism and Related Disabilities. Please welcome Darius Murray.
How's everybody doing today? Great. That's good. I like that. I got responses. Thank you. So my name is Darius Murray, and I am the iRise2 Mentoring Program Coordinator at Florida Atlantic University's Center for Autism and Related Disabilities. A little bit about me. I'm a mentor myself, a community disability advocate. I'm a certified vocational rehabilitation counselor. I'm a 3D printing enthusiast, and I'm a proud new father. Thank you. At Florida Atlantic University Center for Autism and Related Disabilities, we provide services and support for over 5,000 individuals within five counties in South Florida. We provide education, consultation, and technical assistance to individuals who have been impacted by autism and related disabilities, along with their parents, professionals, as well as their family members. We do this at zero cost to the family or the individual and the professional at the same time. The IRISE2 mentoring program stands for Interest in Relationships Impacting Social Engagement and Employment. Our goal is to help individuals diagnosed with autism reach their full potential, not only for independence, but for vocational success. Our protégés are between the ages of 11 and 22 years old, higher functioning individuals with autism, but they just need a little bit of help, kind of getting into the conversation, but also getting into the world of employment. We provide trainings for mentors, we train community advocates, we train community mentors, we train community partners. We do all of this while hosting our own STEM-based mentoring programs, like our Girls Who Code, which is one of the nation's first. All Girls Who Code cluster that has only students with autism or disability in it. And then also our Tinker Tank robotics program, where we're building sea perch robots and doing all kinds of really cool stuff with reusable energy. More importantly, we have our IRISE2 Disability Mentoring Day. And that day really is one of the reasons why we're here today. It's actually next week on October 19th. It's a national day, but in Palm Beach, we have been given a proclamation to celebrate the day and help push forward the efforts of mentoring in the workplace. A few years ago, I met Sarah Fabian and some of the members of the LexisNexis team at one of our fundraisers. And this was just such a dynamic group, and we said, we gotta do something together. There's gotta be something we can do. And IRISE2 Disability Mentoring Day came about. That was a day that we chose to go ahead and host the first inclusive ECL code camp for our students on the spectrum, and it was a true career development event. Let's go ahead and take a look and see how that event went.
For a lot of adults on the spectrum, it can be tough to find a job. The now South County reporter Miranda Christian spent this day at FAU, where they've designed a program to help people learn the skills necessary to find good work.
This may look like a boring office meeting, but this is where people come to learn life lessons. Students with the FAU IRISE2 program are finding out what it takes to land that job after college.
We always need to get new talent, and the one way to get new talent is to tap into talent pools like FAU.
These students just happen to live with autism.
As I'm autistic, people are not easy. People are complicated.
Chelsea Morgan says this one-on-one interaction is exactly what she needs.
Told me I have more confidence in interviewing than what I thought I did.
The company LexisNexis is offering the training. The students got to learn how to code and were even taught a complex coding system they all mastered.
Every one of them developed their own systems and they answered a number of different questions.
The program director says this was the first time they have done this outreach with a company.
Over 1 million individuals that are unemployed with a disability, but half of those individuals have employable disabilities.
But opportunities like this will help any student who is ready to step into the world after college.
Like, I am actually job hunting right now, and that's been the big thing stressing me out.
In Boca Raton, I'm Miranda Christian, the Now, South Florida.
So these students were given a set of taxicab fare data from some large cities, and they were challenged to do something creative with it, and then be able to articulate what they did with that data to a large group, a little bit smaller than this one, well, a lot smaller, but a group of individuals that they've never met before, and they were coached by some mentors, they were assisted by individuals like Flavio and Bob and all these other individuals who took their time to kind of really coach our individuals. They did a great job. They really model the skills that they have that we didn't know they may have had, or they wouldn't have never gotten the opportunity to showcase. After the event, my phone wouldn't stop ringing. I got phone calls as far as Kansas, and I got one phone call from Toronto, which I thought was really interesting. But people heard about this event, and they thought, wow, this is amazing. This is an opportunity for our students to grow. This is an opportunity for our students to experience what the workforce is like and get real-world exposure. But more importantly, they learned something while they were there. They learned how to work as a team. They learned how to go through a process and showcase what they could really do. The parents themselves said that this was the most valuable lessons that the students could ever get. We can teach them anything at FAU. They can learn, they can interpret it, and they can excel. But getting in front of individuals like yourselves is what really drives them. It's what's really gonna help them and give them the skills that they need to excel and not be passed by tomorrow's challenges. The IRISE2 Mentoring Day, Disability Mentoring Day, and the ECL Code Project has really expanded. Now we offer mock job interviews, a resume support, there's job shadowing that goes along, and the best part about it, from what I hear from the students, is the infamous data center tour. I think we lost a couple of them in the cloud, but hey, we'll get them back, all right? Again, this opportunity provides them with the outlet to be able to showcase their skills, to learn directly from the environment. What is it like? What the expectations are of a workplace, but also when you're working in a team, there's turn-taking skills you have to admit. There's ways to talk to individuals. There's ways to kind of break those problems down so that way you can achieve a common goal. We're providing that underrepresented population with a platform to showcase their skills, their knowledge, and excel, build the confidence that they need. Every time we have this event, and we've had maybe three or four at this point, the resonating tone is that whenever I walk into LexisNexis, despite the free soda and all the cool stuff you guys got, we feel accepted. We feel like we're amongst nice, like-minded individuals who care about us and who just want us to succeed. They don't judge us. They're here to coach us and teach us. And I think that's the piece that we need to kind of continue to resonate throughout our communities. Acceptance, understanding, and helping individuals grow. So thank you guys for modeling those skills. The support from LexisNexis has continued to grow, and we've received a few donations that were really great. They've helped our Tinker Tank program grow. Now we're teaching individuals more about STEM and computer science, and they're doing problem solving. But more importantly, we've connected with some of the great mentors that you guys are and volunteers. You guys come out and you help our students with some of these challenges that they have, whether it's building a solar power car or putting together a catapult or trying to figure out why a solar power car won't work, because we need someone with a little bit of a background in electronics and voltage. Think different things. The areas that I can't always cover, you guys have always stepped up and really provided great assistance. You guys have been connecting us with other community members. We've actually been able to come out and help provide education about inclusive employment practices, along with resources that are available for community members. So now, we feel like we're really a part of the LexisNexis family as a community provider and as a stakeholder with some of the donations you guys have provided with us. We know that our students who have attended some of these events are 2 times more likely to pursue a career in STEM. These students have stated that they feel better prepared and more confident when going into any type of interview, but even more so when they go into an interview that's computer science related. Even if it's working as, one student is now working at a church, and they handle all the audiovisual equipment. And they said after that interview, after their mock interview with LexisNexis, it really helped them to get that position with the church. And I thought that was awesome. Our parents feel that this is what we need to do more of. Our parents are saying, and our providers are saying, we need more of these events. We need to challenge the community to open up their doors and teach. Do what you guys do best. And I think that's where we found the best use of this program. The employment expectations have, the understanding of employment expectations has increased, but the nervousness around employment has decreased because you understand what is required of you. So continuing with LexisNexis, with this amazing program that we've been able to collaborate with, we would like to continue helping to develop the employable skills of our individuals with disabilities, not only autism, but any other disability that may come about. We would like to possibly host a 4-day ECL code camp that has a certification endorsed, so that way it helps our individuals get more job placement, maybe even job placement with LexisNexis. And more importantly, we'd like to be able to have LexisNexis be our first autism-friendly technology business in the South Florida area, which would be a great feat for all of us. So before I leave and before I wrap up, I just want to say again, thank you so much for doing what you do, opening your doors, extending your hearts, being kind, being generous, but more importantly, giving our students the tools they need to succeed today so that they won't be surpassed by tomorrow's challenges. Thank you for what you do.
Okay, thank you, all right. Thank you, Darius, for giving us an overview on this wonderful program and for the opportunities you are giving these students. And also thank you to a number of our employees who do volunteer this time, their mentoring skills to help Darius and his mission. As you saw, he has a bunch of next steps, so please reach out to him, anybody in our Boca office, South Florida area, to help him out. All right, so to close out our academic track, I am really excited to have this next speaker share her story with us and how she challenged the status quo to inspire and encourage more girls to get involved in STEM-related activities. Please welcome NSU University school student and founder of Gadget Girls, Ronnie Shashua.
Good morning. My name's Ronnie Shashua, and I'm a senior at NSU University School, which is a high school in Davie, Florida. I'm also the founder of a program called Gadget Girls, which, as Trish said, is a program, an outreach program designed to encourage more young girls in the community to learn robotics. So I started robotics in ninth grade. Before robotics, I had done a little bit of coding. I enjoyed it a lot, and I thought that the next step was robotics. I'd never built anything before, and so when I joined the robotics team and took a robotics class, it was to my luck that I discovered that we use something called VEX Robotics. And VEX Robotics is a competition and educational program that uses standardized parts to make it accessible to beginners. So later on, when I was beginning Gadget Girls, this is the program I decided to use. I really enjoyed this class, and I thought it was a lot of fun in the academic track. Not to brag, but me and my other friends in the class were the best students, so I did get a lot of respect from the other students. But when I went to my first competition in the middle of ninth grade, imagine me, this tiny little freshman girl, walks into the competition, and right in front of me is a group of about a dozen boys on the ground in the middle of a push-up competition, telling each other how their grandma can do more push-ups than them. And that was my introduction to the community of robotics. It was a bit of a culture shock. And I quickly realized that not only was it a very hyper-masculine environment in our local competition environment, but it was also, there were no girls. I was on one of the only teams with any girls on it, and there was maybe two or three other teams with girls. It's gone rather improved in the later years. There was an all-girls team at States last year, but really, there's nothing. And so when I started looking at it, you'll find that women are incredibly underrepresented in all STEM fields, except for life sciences. And I have a couple statistics up on this board from the National Girls Collaborative Project that are basically just telling you, especially in engineering and computer science, representation for women, and especially women of ethnic and racial minorities, is really bad. You can probably tell there's about 18% of students in computer sciences in universities are women. 20% of engineers are women. It's not great. And so one thing I was looking at is that this comes from a variety of different factors. Primarily, there are very few role models for women. I was very interested in space as a kid, and I grew up hearing about Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin and John Glenn and all these classic household names, and I didn't find out about Sally Ride until about sixth grade. And then all of a sudden I was like, whoa, I could also be an astronaut. And this isn't something that most girls have. If they have no role models, they don't have anyone to look up to that they can aspire to be. So that's one factor keeping girls out of STEM fields. As well as that, girls tend to get a lot less encouragement in school and at home. I was an athlete, as well as my sister, from a very young age, so I wasn't stuck at home playing with Barbies or anything, but I didn't start playing with Legos until I joined the Lego Robotics Club in sixth grade. And so that's something that is very common among girls, and then you find that when you start taking classes in robotics, coding, anything in that vein, you're already disadvantaged. You're already behind, and if you're in a class that's all boys that know what they're doing, it's really intimidating to raise your hand and ask questions. And a lot of times, it's not worth the effort. And so I think for me, what I thought is that the best way to encourage more girls to join STEM fields later on in their educational and careers, it was important to find a way to get them into safe and encouraging environments where they could learn to explore their interests. And that's where Gadget Girls come in. When I first came to this realization, I was working in a program called Math Circles, which is just several girls from the high school go down to the elementary school to teach fourth and fifth grade girls fun math problems. And I thought, okay, I can do that with robotics. I'm lucky enough to go to a school that dedicates a lot of funding towards robotics, as well as HPCC, who sponsors our robotics team. So I knew that staying in the school wouldn't make much of a difference. And so I thought if I could find a way to bring robotics to the greater Broward community, it would start to maybe make a difference. And that's where HPCC came in. Obviously, it's quite expensive to get the equipment and the software necessary to do anything with robotics, even with VEX, which is dedicated towards beginners. And so after putting together a budget proposal, HPCC came in and said, we are willing to sponsor this program and give this opportunity to take off and bring robotics to a lot of girls who wouldn't really otherwise have the opportunity. So once we had our funding secured, we were able to begin really planning. I wanted to make a curriculum that would be both simple enough for beginners to learn. I was aiming it towards girls in fourth and fifth grade, but also find a way to make it really interesting and make it functional. So I wanted to teach them not just skills that would help them get started in learning about robotics and coding and engineering, but also help give them life skills. So skills they would find useful later on if they decided to pursue a career in STEM. As well as that, I had to obtain the equipment thanks to the funding by HPCC Systems. I was able to get everything that we needed for the program and even a little bit extra in case anything got damaged later on in the process. So this involves a lot of things. So there's the metal to build the actual frame of the robot, the screws, the nuts, everything. But it also involved the processors, which in VEX is called the microcontroller, the joysticks, batteries, everything we needed to make sure that these girls had everything they could need or want in order to learn more about robotics and explore their interests. So this is where I started session one. I was working through the Girl Scouts at this point, since because of Title IX restrictions, I wasn't able to just make a public program just for girls, since again, Title IX. So I worked through the Girl Scouts, and I was lucky enough to find out that the Girl Scouts had just come up with a robotics badge, which worked perfectly, so I got to incorporate that into my curriculum. So for session one, there were 17 Girl Scouts who came in for this pilot program, and the program was going to be about an hour and a half, and this was the first session, and I wanted to have a second one as well, so that I would give them a lot of time to learn everything they could. So session one was just the basics. It was just helping them learn that this is something they could have fun with, something that was interesting. So I wanted to do all the basics, but I wanted to keep it fun and interactive. So for example, in this picture you see, we made them an obstacle course. But the trick to this obstacle course is that they had to team up. And in groups of three, each person would take a different role of a robot. So one person was a sensor, one person was the processor, and one person was the actual robot itself that was moving through the course. And so through that, they were able to understand all the different functions of the different pieces of the robot and how it all comes together to give you a physical product. And then for the other part of the computer science side of that session is I wanted them to understand how robots and computers think. In order to do this, you have to get away from assumptions and inferences. As I'm sure you all know, computers can't understand what we're telling them. You need to go through every single step. So using one of my robotics team peers who had came to help me out, we forced the girls to walk us through the entire process of sitting down in a chair at a desk. So it's not just go to the desk. It's you have to pick up your leg, you have to step forward, and you have to put it back down. And so through this entire process, we got them to really think about how you would put code in, so almost like pseudocode verbalized. And for the second part of this session, I wanted them to practice building. I wanted them to start on their robots. So we got them comfortable with all the different pieces and tools we were using, and we had them start the chassis of their robot. And that was what we were doing for session one in order to make sure that everyone was understanding the basics, knew what was going on, and was interested to come again and also hopefully further their knowledge later on. For session two, I think it was the bulk of the hard work because this is where they finished the robots and programmed it. For me, the point of this session was teamwork and communication. Do these girls know how to work in teams? I put them in groups of three. As you can see, these three girls are working in one team to put together their robot. And no one person is allowed to do the same thing twice. So they have to rotate. In order to do this, obviously, they have to work together. So there were some hiccups along the way, as I'm sure you would assume. They're fourth and fifth grade girls. But we got them working together to finish their robots and give them little programs so they could drive them around. And once they did that, they were able to present their robots to their parents. And this was just for the first year of the program. Later on, for this year, for example, I want to start doing three sessions. With the third session, we can give them a little bit more freedom in building. We can have them add sensors, add more parts to their robot. We can also have them program more exciting things with their robot. One thing I want to do is have them play freeze tag, which is something I did as a ninth grade student in the beginner's robotics class, is you have a sensor to freeze and a sensor to go forward. And then with that, you can make a real game of freeze tag, but with robots. So I think as long as I'm making it fun, but also interesting, I think I'm going to be incorporating it. Another part of this is I want them to have a bigger presentation of their robots. I think in any STEM field, it's incredibly important that you be able to communicate your ideas, like I'm doing right now. If you have great ideas and amazing prototypes, you're not going to go anywhere unless you can present them to people who are going to put you in the right places to get it, make it happen. And so I think that's going to be really important. So one plan for that is to have them present their robots in the atrium of the library to all the library goers and have them really show people what they've been doing. So little fourth and fifth grade girls showing off their robots to all the university students or the local library patrons who come in and get to see their robots perform. So I think it's going to be really exciting for them. And so I think that's really important to make sure they're staying invested in this and understanding that this is something they can have fun with. In the future, I hope to keep this available. I'm a senior right now, so I'll be graduating, but there are a couple girls helping me out that are younger than me and who will be able to continue the program after I'm gone. As well as that, the equipment that HPCC so generously donated stays in the public library. So I put that all into a kit so that when it's not in use by the program, people can come in and check out the kit. A big problem is that a lot of the students in the area don't have the funds to have access to this kind of technology. So with this checkout kit, I want to make sure that people who wouldn't otherwise have it are able to access this technology to really further in their interest and really grow as students learning about STEM and engineering in particular. For the future, my goal is to expand the program. Already, we're doing three sessions for the fall semester of this year. There's a session in October, one in November, and one in December, and it all goes together so that the girls can learn even more. I want to also bring it to larger audiences, so open up the program to more girls. And I also want to further the outreach. I want to reach more girls who aren't in the Girl Scouts, but still they deserve access to this kind of technology and this kind of opportunity. I'm currently working with someone at the Boys and Girls Club to help bring this program to them. And also, I'm trying to put together a proposal to bring it into the Broward County Public Schools. And I think at the end of the day, the most important thing of this program for me is to make sure that more people have the opportunities that I had as a student at university school and that HPCC so kindly granted us. This technology isn't free. A lot of people don't have access to it. And as our world becomes more and more reliant on this kind of technology in the workforce, these girls, by not having access to this technology at young ages like other people do, they're being put at a disadvantage later on in life, in their university years and in their careers. If you have any questions, please let me know. My email is here, and I'll also be taking questions after this. I'm with the university school booth in booth 200. We're doing a demonstration of one of our world championship robots from last year. So if you'd like to come speak with me, ask me any questions about how maybe you could bring this to your own community and help other girls get access to this technology and these opportunities, please just come and speak with me and let me know, or just send me an email. Thank you.
Hey, thank you, Ronnie, and you know, congratulations on stepping up, challenging yourself, and for everything that you're doing to bring more girls into STEM-related fields. All right, so Flavio, you want to come up and join me? This is part of my favorite part of the agenda is the community award ceremony. But first, you know, it sounds like we really need more Darius and Ronnies in the world. Okay.
Well, everyone else has helped us well. It takes a village to do these things, and I do need to recognize everyone here and outside of here that have been also helping with all of these programs. Every mentor, every person that organized it, Sarah right there in the middle, that helped bring all of these things together and introduce us to some of these people. This is wonderful. It's great to see this in some communities. I wish we could see more communities with this type of opportunities as well, and people motivated to go the extra mile to bring some of these things to people that don't have the same type of advantages or they don't have the mediums to get there. Mm-hmm. I do truly believe that we can do far more than what we do for our normal job. There are more things that go above and beyond. And as you grow older, I don't want to date myself, you start getting a new perspective on things, right? Some things that seem to be extremely important. Now they are, yeah, they're very important, but you really find out the value in life and the important things. So this type of initiatives are really, really important.
All right.
Anyway.
Thank you. All right. So we had 13 participants in this year's poster competition, of which 5 were international students dialing in over Skype. So hopefully they are watching us over the live stream as we get ready to announce the winners. So it was a tough job for our 4 judges. Thank you to Fabian, Jim, Sarah, and Tony Kirk. I got the results, Flavio. First up, though, I want to let you know that only 2 points separated first and second place.
Okay. Tough competition.
Yep. And if I, at this time, if I can also just have all of the 8 poster participants that are here in the room, just come up on stage and be recognized. Where are you? There you go. Come on up. All fit. Great, great. So just some of the commentary that I just pulled when we were, Sharon and I were late in the night tabulating all the scores. Great real-world application, very innovative, using big data to tell a story, love it, great contribution to industry, challenges the status quo. That was probably on every single one of the score sheets was challenging the status quo. A necessary evil. And you got to figure out whose this one is. Cybersecurity will love this. Okay, so well done. All right, so I'm going to turn it now over to Flavio to announce the winners. I got the envelopes right here.
Very good. This is the suspense.
Yep, there you go.
Maybe we should make a mistake now, and that would be another. Very good. For the third place, we have a poster on cybersecurity-related topic. This is using a clustering mechanism or methodology to do unsupervised learning on log-based anomaly detection. And this third place award goes to Vanel Suvak.
Congratulations.
This is great. Well done. Good.
The envelope.
Mm. So, second place, this is identification of correlation between mental illness and substance abuse or substance use. This is also a very good poster, if you have seen it outside. Interesting enough to really grab my attention as well to go through the details. Of course, doesn't get into the what is cause and what is consequence. You have an illness first and then you use substances or vice versa. But it does show a very interesting degree of positive correlation across those two facts. So if you haven't seen it, go take a look. And this second place is for Alyssa Messner. Well done.
Congratulations. And here we go.
Perfect. Now, the big winner is So there is a poster there on the interesting applied research that a student that has been with us, with the community for some time. I can disclose that it's not his first time in the rodeo, but it's certainly his best time ever. He had done a very good poster on GPU accelerated deep learning on HPCC. And I guess I gave it away already. So this first place is for Robert Kennedy. Robert, well done.
All right, well, congratulations to you all. Thank you so much for...
And those in the live stream as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Of course, unfortunately, you weren't here, but those were also very good posters.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. Thank you. And hopefully we can do this again now that we've got this new age technology. Sharon and I don't know how many times we did dry runs, but we eventually got it. So thank you. Thank you for all your participation.
Thank you, folks, for all the effort.
You can go exit this way, this way to see you get your certificate. It's okay. All right, so now I'm going to turn it over to Flavio to announce our HPCC Systems Community Recognition Award.
And every year we recognize a person in the HPCC community that truly is engaged with the community and goes above and beyond and demonstrates this commitment over time as well. It's not just a sprint. This is a marathon. So and there are people that truly make the extra effort, like traveling thousands of miles from abroad just to get here every year. And this is something that doesn't go unpunished. So for this recognition, really, I want to award this particular award to Fabian Fear. I don't know where Fabian is. Yeah. So please join us here on stage for the award. Fabian, thank you very much for all you have done. We grant this to a person that we consider important to the community and that has been continuously doing things that have supported our community and help expand it, and you really deserve it.
Thank you very much. Thank
you. And our final award goes to our HPC Systems David Kahn Ambassador Award, so I'll let Flavio do the honors.
Very good. So, this award goes to a person that has been involved with expanding the community, that has done community outreach efforts, that has engaged universities, industry partners, other people in the open source community. In this particular case, it goes to someone that has done this also in a distant geography, at least distant from here, Atlanta, and that has been doing this for several years. He even relocated to another country to do some of these things. So this award goes to Claudio Amaral. Claudio, are you there? Come to the stage. We really appreciate all you have done and all the work that you've done in Brazil and above and beyond Brazil, helping the community. Thank you.
Okay. Hey. All right, well, congratulations to all of our winners. All the work and contributions that you do is truly amazing. Okay, so before you guys break for lunch and exit the room, which, by the way, this is the only event that I've seen on the registration form where the dietary selections were more to choose from than the breakout sessions themselves.
So very true. That's a good factor.
You guys are in for a treat. There's something for everyone.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
All right, so here's
even though last night at dinner, it was hard to find the desserts, which were at the back of the room.
Yeah, they were here. Maybe they did that purposely because they knew the workout and the expo and was coming up. So. And all the probiotics talk.
Of course.
They're prepping us, so. All right, so here's the rundown for this afternoon. Go enjoy your lunch. At 1 p.m. sharp, the Interactive Expo opens again. And then at 1:30, please head to your designated breakout session. The name of the breakout will appear right outside the door. If you get lost, feel free to just locate anyone with the committee badge, and they'll help you. And then after the 3 p.m. break, return here, back in the ballroom, for our final roadmap tech talks, okay? Enjoy your afternoon, thank you.
Thank you.